done, boy. You're finished already. Look at me. Look at me. You know you're done. You are.
Ali. Ali.
يقاتل المسلمون اليهود فيقتلهم المسلمون ويختبئ اليهودي وراء الحجر والشجر فينادي الحجر والشجر قائلا يا مسلم يا عبد الله هذا يهودي خلفي تعالى فاقتل إلا الغرقد فإنه من شجر اليهود.
And you have no idea how much I hope Allah is going to curse you to the rest of your life.
You are Ali. Ali.
Hello and welcome everybody. God bless you. I hope everybody had a wonderful celebration for the new year. I hope everybody is healthy and blessed in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I hope you had a wonderful small vacation together, guys, with your families, with your loved ones. God bless you. God bless your families. Thank you for joining in. I know it was a couple of busy days. This is why I didn't come online again. So please forgive me if you missed our live shows, but it's never late, right, guys? I had some wonderful days with my family too, and really had a blessed Christmas and celebration of the new year. Guys, before we start today's live show, before we started teaching, did Prophet Muhammad ever sin? That's the topic of today. Let us pray in the name of our Lord and Savior so he can bless our live show today. Pray with me, guys. Dear Lord, bless our beloved audience. Lord, thank you for your grace and thank you for the amazing last year. Thank you, Lord, for my lovely audience and subscribers who kept supporting me day in, day out for the last year. Please, Lord, bless them and bless their families. Keep all of us healthy and safe in 2020, Lord. Father, enfold us in your arms. Help us not to lean on our own understanding, but in everything acknowledge you, Lord, so that you can direct our words, thoughts, and action. Please, God, give us a measure of your strength so that we might not give in to discouragement, deception, taqiyah, lies, and doubt. Help us honor you in all our ways, Lord. God, please fill me with your Holy Spirit and loosen my tongue today so I can speak the truth without any error or any shame. Please, Lord, give me wisdom and courage to do whatever needs to be done. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Welcome, everybody. On this live broadcast today, we'll have the opportunity today to investigate if Muhammad ever sinned when he was or became, let's say, a so-called prophet 1400 years ago. And like always, we will have a nice Q&A session in the end after we are finished our teaching. So if you have any questions, please hold your horses and ask me your questions in the live chat when I'm done teaching. If there are Muslims here watching, listening, my Skype is now open. You can call us live on our live show. You have now finally the opportunity to call us live and maybe you can refute us. I noticed that someone was calling me when I was not live. There's no point to call me when I'm not live. I think that was the guy who always used to steal his Wi-Fi of the neighbors, right? Steal the Wi-Fi of his neighbors. So if you are listening, my friend, call me now. Don't call me when I'm not live, when I'm not doing a live show. There's no point in calling me. Again, my Skype ID is the Rob Christian. As you see, the admins already provided that in the live chat. So let me first say welcome to our audience, people who are watching, people in the chat, Jason Palmer, Frau Kolig, Phil Herrera, sorry if I'm butchering your name, guys, Tamara, TM Crosspools, Angel, Unicorn, Aaron, Joseph, Pyatt, 1173, Shelly, Christian Guardian, hello, my friend from Discord, welcome, Cole Kandu, Punisher RA, if I forgot to mention your name, guys, you are many. Thank you for being here. God bless you. Forgive me if I didn't mention your name. Now, let us start our live show, guys. Let us start our live show. As you see here, the topic of today is, did Prophet Muhammad ever sin? Did the Prophet of Islam ever sin? Hello, Carrie-Anne. Thank you for your donation, sister. Thank you for your support. Carrie-Anne is saying, thank you so much for what you do for us, Rob. No, thank you. Thank you, Carrie-Anne, for your support. Thank you for being here. Thank you for the donation. God bless you. God bless your families. Now, why did I pick this topic today, guys? Because Muslims, when you ask them, did Prophet Muhammad ever sin? The answer is no. Why no? Well, yeah, Muhammad didn't say yes. He made mistakes. According to the Muslims, he made mistakes, but he never sinned. What? Just tell the truth one. I don't like to refute the same guy every live show. There's no point. Okay? So let Farid ask your boyfriend Farid, if you're a Muslim, ask him to call me. Or maybe you can call me. If you are a Muslim, you can call me right here, right now, and tell me where we are lying. I mean, last time we already spanked him. There's no need to spank the same guy over and over. So if he has any courage or knowledge, let him call me. I'm not going to do a response video every time I go live. No, that's a waste of time. It's a waste of time. You have something to say to us? Call us. Don't be a coward. Be a man. Install Skype and call us. You're a Christian. Okay, why are you just to tell? I mean, my friend, are you going to say that every time? Many people are actually not helping us by saying that every time. Do you really think that I'm going to do a response video every time I go live about this kid? Who is he, man? Well, it says here that the stream is healthy from my side, Carrie-Anne. So you have to do a refresh. Okay? Do a refresh. I think it's from your side. Guys, can you hear me? Is my sound loud and clear? I hope my sound is loud and clear. God, please bless today's live show so we can do a healthy and good live stream, live broadcast. Please, Lord. So let us start, guys. Please, guys, don't ask me every time, please respond to this guy or this guy. If this guy has guts, let him call me, okay? Don't come every time with this nonsense. Now, when we ask Muslims, did Jesus sin? Did Jesus sin? They say no. Okay, but wait a second. You're telling me that the prophets did not sin? The prophets in Islam did not sin? The answer is no, brother. The answer is no, brother? Okay, I see. Well, if you are not sinning, doesn't that mean you are basically perfect? Are you telling me you are having an attribute of God? The prophets are sharing the same attribute of God because, you know, I mean, God does not sin, right? He is not a sinner. And if you're telling me that the prophets do not sin in Islam, that means you are elevating the prophets to the same level of Allah. You see the logic, guys? Did you catch the logic of the Muslims? If the prophets do not sin, that means you are elevating the prophets to the level of Allah. That means you are making them look perfect. Perfect, I mean, you know what perfect means. But brother, they do not sin, but they do mistakes. Aha, they do mistakes. Brother, let's see what the Quran says about Jesus, Isa. They call him Isa, right? There's nothing called Jesus, but let it go, brother, let it go. This is chapter Maryam, Surah Maryam, chapter 19, ayah 19. Here, Jibreel is the one talking. When we ask Muslim, who is this guy talking? It says Jibreel. But wait a second, brother. The Quran is the speech of Allah, brother. So how Jibreel is talking, brother? I don't know, brother. It is what it is, brother. Okay? So here, the one talking is the messenger from Allah. And when we ask, who is that? It says, it's Jibreel, brother. Okay, brother. No problem, brother. So it says, it's talking to Mary, right? Who they call Maryam. Confusing Mary with Maryam, the sister of Aaron and Moses. Which is, of course, at least 1500 years of historical mistake. But let it go, brother. Today we're going to let everything go, brother. Right? Because that's off topic, basically. So here, Jibreel is saying to Maryam, the sister of Aaron and Moses, the daughter of Imran, you will get a gift and he's going to be a holy son. What? Brother, in Islam, Jesus is holy, brother? Yes, brother. Ghulaman Zakiyya. Ghulaman Zakiyya. That means a holy, pure son. Right? A pure boy, brother. So it seems only Jesus is holy. Guys, when we ask a sheikh in Islam, is the Quran holy? No, the Quran is not holy. The Quran is Quran al-Kareem, glorious Quran, right? Is Muhammad holy? No, brother, there's nothing called Muqaddas in Islam. Only Jesus is Muqaddas. He is the only holy person in Islam. What? Yes, brother. So it seems that Jesus is holy. But what about Muhammad, guys? What about Muhammad? If we go to this website, let me give you the link, guys, before we study this website. This is the website, islamqna.info. I just gave you the link. You can open it up and save it, bookmark it. Help me to help you. Always bookmark stuff, guys, that we give you for your own investigation, for your own debates with Muslims. Use them, okay? So, someone is asking this sheikh, Sheikh Muhammad Saleh Al-Munajjid. He is a PhD sheikh. I think he's a Salafi Sunni Muslim. And a Muslim is asking this question to the sheikh. Did the Prophet, Allah is praying on him, there's nothing called peace and blessing, Allah is praying on him, did he commit any sin? That's the question. And the sheikh is issuing his fatwa, fatwa number 7208. And the question is, my question is about the Prophet Muhammad, basically. Some Muslims believe that he was sinless, while others say he was not. So even the Muslims among themselves do not agree. Do you see it? So some Muslims believe that he is sinless, other Muslims say no. So there's a huge confusion. But let it go, brother. Let it go. I personally don't think he was sinless. So this Muslim saying, the Muslim who is asking the question is saying, I personally don't think Muhammad was sinless because he was just a man. Thank you. This Muslim who is asking the question, he's also giving his opinion, right? He's giving his opinion saying, I mean, if Muhammad is only a man, only a warner, according to the Quran, Muhammad is only a warner. He is a human. He is He's just a mere man who gave the message, right? The message of who? Of Allah, through Jibreel. So this guy actually understands this cannot, this, how is this possible? I mean, Muhammad claims to be a man like you, like me, right? But how do you Muslims actually, so he's asking the Sheikh, how is this? Can you tell me which is true? Using Quran or Hadith, please. Thank you very much. Allahu Akbar. So the question from this Muslim. And now let's see what the Sheikh is going to answer, guys. Here's the answer from the Sheikh. Okay? Alhamdulillah. Praise be to Allah, says the Sheikh. He always starts with that. Firstly, the use of the word sin, says the Sheikh. This is the words of the Sheikh, right? This is Sheikh Muhammad Salih al-Munajjid. He says, the use of the word sin in the question is a grave mistake. Wow. So actually, as you see immediately, the Sheikh is saying, don't use the word sin. So basically, Muhammad did not sin. Right? Muhammad didn't sin, Sheikh? No, brother. Muhammad was not a sinner, brother. It's impossible in the case of the messengers. Did you catch it? So it's a huge sin to say that messengers sinned in Islam. So basically, the Sheikh again is elevating Muhammad and all the prophets and the messengers to the level of Allah. Because, I mean, if you are not sinning, that means you are divine. I mean, how can you be a human and not sin at the same time? That doesn't make sense, right, people? I mean, come on, think here, Muslims. Think with me. How can you claim that Muhammad is a man if he did not sin? So clearly, he has the same level. He's equal to his creator. And in the Quran says, blessed be, right? Allah, the best of creators. Tabarak Allah, Ahsan al-Khaliqeen, right? Blessed be Allah. And it seems that there are many creators. So I think, you know, this is really a topic that Muslims really need to start think about. Like this person who actually believes, he says, quote unquote, I personally don't think he was sinless because he was just a man. So how does Muhammad claim to be a man, but at the same time, you Muslims, said, and as you see the Sheikh saying, the messengers do not sin. It's more correct to say mistakes. Mistake? I mean, what's the difference between a mistake and a sin? I mean, how can you say they are not sinners, but they make mistakes? Because a mistake may be made unintentionally. Guys, are you catching what is happening here? Are you catching what is happening here? Does this sound logic to you guys? Think with me here. Muslims, think with me. They can make mistakes, but they don't sin. What's the difference? What is the difference between someone doing a mistake? How can you do a mistake, but at the same time, you're not a sinner? I'm trying to understand this, Muslims. Really, I'm trying my best to understand how you can make mistakes, but at the same time, you're not a sinner. I mean, I just, let's say I'm Muhammad, and I just killed a child. Brother, that's not a sin, brother. That's a mistake, brother. Killing someone is a mistake, brother? Yes, brother, because he's a messenger, brother. Even if it's a sin, yes, brother, it's not a sin, brother. Pay attention, brother. It's a mistake, brother. Clearly, you must be a nutcase. You must be stupid to believe that mere humans, like the messengers, are not sinners. So they are sinless, according to the Sheikh. And he continues, secondly, which regard to sins, the messengers, including Muhammad, all the messengers, including Muhammad, never committed any sin intentionally as an act of disobedience towards Allah after receiving their mission. Wait. Guys, did you just catch what the Sheikh said? Are you with me, guys? Are you with me? The Sheikh is saying Muhammad never committed any sin, including all the messengers, intentionally as an act of disobedience towards Allah after receiving their mission. What? Guys, you need to remember this, okay? Take some notes, write this down. According to the Sheikh, Muhammad never committed any sin intentionally as an act of disobedience towards Allah after receiving his mission. Let's say the Quran. The Quran was the mission of Muhammad, right? To deliver the Quran to the people. Now, guys, let us see if we can destroy this claim. Let us see if we can destroy this claim today. Right here, right now. Let us do some investigation. All right, guys? Let me take you on a trip. Let us go together on a trip through today's live show and see if we can destroy this claim of this Abdul Sheikh. What was his name again? Sheikh Muhammad Saleh Al-Munajjid. Can we? Do you think we can barbecue this Sheikh? Guys, Sheikh Baloney, yeah. Can we barbecue this Sheikh? What do you think, guys? Can we expose this liar, this deceiver? Let us see, guys. If we go to Quran chapter 47, ayah 19, it says, Muhammad is a sinner. Now watch. So know, they put this between brackets to understand that this is Muhammad. So this is a adding by the translator, in this case, Sahih International, is a group of women, by the way. A group of women. Women, brother? Women translating Quran, brother? But women in Islam are half-brained, brother. How are they allowing half-brained women to translate Quran, brother? I don't know, brother. You need to ask yourself that if you're a Muslim. And this is, by the way, the most used English translation for the Quran. Sahih International, written by three women. Yes, I kid you not. And two of them are at least converts to Islam. Brother, converts who learned Arabic? Yes, brother. Yeah. Half-brained women translating the Quran of Allah. And it's the most used translation of the Quran. Because you know how many Muslims don't know Arabic? More than 80% of the Muslim world do not speak Arabic. So they are dependent on translations like these, right? So let me continue. So know, O Muhammad, that there is no deity except Allah, and ask forgiveness for your sin. Bam! So according to the Quran itself, Muhammad needs to ask for forgiveness for his sin. Brother, the Sheikh just said Muhammad was not a sinner, brother. Yes, Gideon. Sahih International is translated by women. Yeah. So here, as you see, the Quran actually claims that Muhammad is a sinner. And Muhammad needs to ask for forgiveness for his sins. So clearly, Muhammad is a sinner like you, and like me, like everyone else, according to the Quran. But brother, the Sheikh just said, Muhammad never committed any sin. But wait, why does Muhammad need to ask for forgiveness for his sin if he never committed any sin? You see the deception in taqiyah, guys. Sunnis, they say taqiyah is only for Shia, brother. But this is a Sunni Sheikh, brother. Taqiyah is only for Shia, you liars. Do you have any shame, Muslims? So according to the Quran, Muhammad needs to ask forgiveness for his sins. Can we go actually to the Quran itself, brother? Maybe this is your own translation, brother. No. Look at the Quran, guys. This is the same chapter, same ayah. So know, O Muhammad, that there is no deity except Allah, and ask forgiveness for your sin. Uh-oh. Oh boy. So do you think the Sheikh is correct? I mean, why would you ask forgiveness if you are not a sinner, right? So clearly this sheikh, is he a Muslim calling the Quran of Allah lies? What salawat means? That means prayers. Salawat means prayers. Suddenly he become a Shia sheikh. So the sheikh is actually against his own Quran. Do you see it? Muhammad, basically all the messengers, they don't sin. Never, I mean never committed any sin. But wait, Allah is asking Muhammad to ask for forgiveness. Oh my Allah, yeah, oh my Allah, something is strange. Something is fishing, brother, fishing, brother. Fishy, brother. Why are you fishing, brother? Brother, Sheikh, brother, you're Sunni Sheikh, PhD Sheikh, brother. Why are you against your own Quran, brother? Didn't I tell you that I'm going to spank and barbecue this Sheikh? Yes, I did. So who is correct here? Basically, the guy who's asking the question. He says, I personally don't think that Muhammad was sinless because he was inhuman. So the guy who's asking the question is actually correct. Where does it say mistakes? Where does it say mistakes in the Quran? Where, I will give you $1,000 if it says, if this ayah says mistakes. I will give you $1,000 if this ayah is mentioning mistakes, or does it say your sin? Uh-oh. Yeah, the Quran refutes the sheikh, exactly. The Quran is refuting this sheikh who is claiming that Muhammad, including all the messengers, did not commit any sin. Never! So you see the logic? You see the logic of the shuyukh, guys. They are calling themselves scholars and shuyukh, but the Quran is against them. They are calling the Quran of Allah lie. You see how when we barbecue a sheikh, he becomes a kebab sheikh. You see how Muslim shuyukh are nothing but kebab? Yeah. Anyone interested in some kebab sheikh? Kebab? Brother, stop barbecuing our shuyukh, brother. So you see, guys, why I chose today's topic? You see why I chose today's topic, guys? You see how important such topics is? Yeah, kebab with some hummus and tabbouleh on the side. Great dish, brother. What about Muhammad himself? What did Muhammad say, guys, about sins? What did Muhammad say about sins? Let us investigate that. If we go to Sahih Muslim, Hadith number 2749, let me give you the link, copy it, bookmark it, save it. Take notes, guys. Okay, save those links, use them whenever you have a debate about this topic, about this very topic. According and reported by Abu Huraira, reports that Allah's Messenger having said, so Muhammad is saying this, right? By him in whose hand is my life, i.e. Allah, right? By him in whose hand is my life, i.e. Allah, if you were not to commit sin, according to Muhammad, if you as a human, what? If you as a human do not commit sin, Allah would sweep you out of existence and he would replace you by those people who would commit sin and seek forgiveness from Allah, and he would have pardoned them. So you see, according to Muhammad himself, every human being, guys, are you seeing what I'm seeing? Are you reading with me? Give me one if you're still with me. According to Muhammad, every human must commit sin, else Allah would remove you out of existence completely. So Allah, it seems that Allah likes people to sin. I mean, why do you need Allah if you are not a sinner? Right, Muslims? Did you catch what Muhammad just said? This is Muhammad speaking, right, guys? This is Sahih Muslim. This is Hassan Hadith. Or actually, no, this is Sahih Hadith. Sorry. This is Sahih Hadith. This is Sahih Muslim. Sorry, Sahih Muslim. Sahih, brother. pay attention, Rob Christian. It's sahih Muslim, brother. Okay, okay. Don't worry, be happy. It's sahih, brother. Authentic, brother. Speaking from Kif, Hira, Hira, Hira. It's sahih, sahih, sahih. Hadith, brother. So, according to this hadith from the mouth of Muhammad himself, Allah will remove you from existence if you don't sin. So this is why, this is why Allah is saying to Muhammad, ask forgiveness for your sin. Else Allah will remove Muhammad himself from existence. What? Yes, brother. Do you see how we just barbecued the Sheikh, brother? I'm annoying. Why am I annoying, man? Because we are barbecuing the Sheikh. I know it's annoying. I understand, Rana Hanna. I mean, imagine if Muslims call me a very good guy, you know. This is why they are calling us all kind of names, right? You see, guys? Don't says, Rob, poor intellectual debate at the debate table face to face. Stop hiding behind the scenes. So you want me to show you my face? Brother, why? You want to date me or debate me, brother? Maybe I'm so ugly. If I show you my face, you know, imagine what will happen to you. I'm so ugly, brother. Imagine if you see my face. Do you have any clue what will happen to you, brother? Brother, you want to date me? Why do you want to see my face? Do you want to date me or debate me, brother? Who is the one hiding? I mean, we are live. Our Skype is open. Do you see it? Our Skype is open. Who is the one who is a coward at the moment? You or me? You can call me right here, right now. My Skype is D-Rob Christian. You can call me and see who's the coward. Let's see who has more intellect. You or me, brother? Show me your face, brother. Rob Christian, show me your face. You're finished. Brother, Muhammad is not a sinner, brother. But wait, Abdul. According to Muhammad himself, every human... I mean, he's even talking about himself. Do you see it? Who, by him in whose hand is my life. Right? The life of Muhammad is in the hand of Allah, right? If any human does not commit sin, including Muhammad, Allah would sweep you out of existence. Do you see? So clearly, we showed you from the Quran, we showed you from the Hadith that Allah will remove you from existence if you don't commit sins. All right? But guys, did Allah remove Isa? Did Allah remove Isa from existence? No, brother. Isa is with Allah in paradise, in Jannah, brother. Aha! So clearly, the only sinless person in Islam is Isa, brother. Isa, yes, because he's holy, brother. He is the holy son of Maryam. Pure. Pure and holy. Don't you dare to open debate. I challenge you. Come. This is an open debate. Call me, brother. This is live, brother. What do you want more than this? We are live. We have more than 140 people watching. Why are you such a coward, brother? Show me your face, brother. Maybe I can stab you to death, brother. I can put a knife between your ribs, brother. Aha, this is why you want to see my face, right? It's okay, brother. It's okay. Don't worry, brother. So you see, guys, if you don't sin like Muhammad, Muhammad is clearly a sinner. He needs to ask for forgiveness. Allah else would have removed Muhammad from existence. So clearly Muhammad, but here Muhammad forgot about Isa, right, guys? Because he claimed that Isa is holy. I mean, if you're holy, that means you're not a sinner, right? If Jesus is holy, that means he's not a sinner, he's pure. Do you know what pure holy means? I don't know what they want to do with my face. Maybe, I don't know, maybe he wants to see if I'm beautiful or ugly. Maybe, I don't know. I have no clue why he wants to show me, show him his my face. Show me your face, brother. Coward, Rob Christian, you're finished, brother. Guys, didn't Sheikh claimed that Muhammad, including all the messengers, he did not commit any sin, right? That's what the Sheikh said, and we already barbecued him, but let us barbecue him even more. Never did any messenger commit any sin. Let's see if Muhammad committed a sin. Guys, when we ask Muslims, what is the most or what is the worst sin in Islam? What is the worst sin according to Islam? It's shirk, right? Guys, give me one if you agree with me. Shirk is the worst sin in Islam. You know what shirk means, guys? Can anyone tell me what shirk means? Anyone in the live chat? Guys, forget about this coward. He will never call me because you know what will happen to him. Forget about him. Pay attention, guys. Do you know what shirk means? Can anyone tell me what shirk means? What does the word shirk in Islam means? Frauch is saying association of partners with Allah. Thank you. You're correct, sir. Longiness also, you're correct. Goat ate Aisha's Quran. Exactly. Exactly, Hafsa. Exactly. Good. So let us see. Let us see if Muhammad did that, guys. Let us see if Muhammad became a mushrik. Guys, let us see if Muhammad became a mushrik. Let us see if he committed any shirk associating partners with Allah. Does that sound fair, guys? Does that sound fair to you? Let us see if Muhammad committed the worst sin ever possible in Islam. Right? Let us see that. Let us do some investigation. This is chapter 22, guys. Chapter 22, ayah 52. It says the following. And we did not send before you any messenger or prophet, except that when he spoke or recited what? The Quran, Satan, the devil, threw into it some misunderstanding. Into what? Into the recitation of the Quran. Oh, what does that mean, brother? We'll see in a second what that means. But Allah cancels or abolish that which Satan throws in what? In the Quran, right, guys? Then Allah makes precise his verses, the Quran verses, and Allah is knowing and wise. So when Satan comes in between, right, when Satan comes in between and he gives his own verses inside the Quran, Allah then comes and abolishes that which Satan threw in, right? And the Quran becomes uncorrupted all over again. But wait, why is Allah allowing Satan to come in between anyways? What? So here, actually, the satanic verses are unconfirmed. And Muhammad, because he knew he was a mushrik, so he says, he's saying about all the prophets that they became mushrikeen. Do you see it? They're actually delivering satanic verses, associating partners with Allah. Who are the partners? Allah, Al-Uzza, Al-Manat. Let me prove it to you guys. Let me prove to you that Muhammad was actually a pagan mushrik boy. He committed shirk. But brother, the Sheikh just said that Muhammad never committed any sin. Well, we're going to spank the Sheikh and spank the Prophet of Islam all over again. This is tafsir as Bab al-Nuzul by Al-Wahidi for the Quran. Chapter 22, same ayah, same chapter, ayah 52. Do you see it? Chapter 22, ayah 52. Chapter 22, ayah 52. Do you see it? Asbab al-Nuzul, the reason why, that's the name of the book, by Al-Wahidi, the reason why the Quran ayahs came down in his tafsir. This is tafsir. This word that you see here means tafsir. Okay? Now let me scroll down. Let us see what it's saying. So this is talking about chapter 22, ayah 52. You see it? The commentators of the Quran said, the Mufassirun, like this guy said, when the Messenger of Allah saw that his people were shunning him, he was aggrieved by their rejection. So they were, he was really, actually, you know, not happy, not pleased by the reaction of the pagan Quraysh. They rejected him, right? Basically, they are rejecting him for being a prophet of Allah. So they are rejecting him and his message that he gave to them. And he wished, Muhammad wished, that Allah, exalted is he, reveals something to him which would bring him and his people. Who are those? The Quraysh pagans. They are his own tribe, right, guys? The pagan Quraysh of Mecca were the tribe of Muhammad, the family basically of Muhammad, right? So he really wished that his own people, the Quraysh pagans of Mecca, would come closer to each other. You know, that they would accept Islam and accept him as the Prophet of Allah. So this is tafsir for chapter 22, ayah 52. Keen as Muhammad was, you know, was to see them accept the faith of Islam. So he wanted really, you know, he really wanted that his own pagan Quraysh tribe would accept him and his new faith, Islam. So this happened in Mecca, guys. Pay attention. This is in Mecca. Muhammad did not go to Medina yet. And you need to actually remind this, because I'm going to show you what is happening here. Right? What is happening here? One day, so Muhammad was sitting in Mecca together with his tribe, the pagan Quraysh. One day, he sat in one of the congregations of the Quraysh, the pagan Quraysh, which attracted a huge number of his members. So there were many people there, right, that day. And he wished that Allah, exalted is he, does not reveal to him on that day anything that might repel them from him. Okay, so he wished that Allah will not send him anything that will, you know, make it even more worse for Muhammad. Because already the pagans of Mecca, his own tribe, rejected him and his message, which is Islam and the Quran. So Allah started to reveal Surah An-Najm. What is Surah An-Najm? That's chapter 53, right? Surah An-Najm, chapter 53. So the Messenger of Allah starts suddenly to recite it, right, to the people there who were there. So Muhammad starts to deliver the Quran from chapter 53 to the people. Okay, interesting. This is very interesting, guys. Pay attention. So what happens next? The Messenger of Allah started to recite, but when he reached, have you thought upon Al-Lat and Al-Uzza, Al-Manat, the third, the other, chapter 53, ayah 90 to 20. Let me go there, guys. Chapter 53, ayahs 19 and 20. So when he reached here, guys, when he finished reciting ayah 20, let's see what happened after this. Guys, pay attention. What happened immediately after ayah 20? This is chapter 53, Surah An-Najm, ayah 20. What happens after that? So when he finished ayahs 19 and 20, the devil came in between. What? Liar? How am I lying? This is your own tafsir, Abdul. Ya akhwan, ya akhi. How am I lying? This is your tafsir for the Quran. This is Asbab al-Nuzul by al-Wahidi. Who is lying? I'm only reading. Don't shoot me. I'm just a messenger. Right? So the devil, Shaitan, came in between and he started to put on the tongue of Muhammad what he had secretly wished and hoped for and said, تِلْكَ الْغَرَانِيقَ الْعُلَىٰ إِنَّ شَفَاعَتَهُنَّ لَتُرْتَجَىٰ. These are the mighty cranes, the high gharaniq, the mighty cranes, and their intercession is hoped for. So, as you see, these are the satanic verses. The highlighted blue part that you see here, when someone asks you, what is the satanic verses that Muhammad delivered to the pagan Quraysh? This part. So, immediately after ayah 20, guys, after the question mark, تِلْكَ الْغَرَانِيقَ الْعُلَىٰ إِنَّ شَفَاعَتَهُنَّ لَتُرْتَجَىٰ. These are the mighty cranes, their intercession is open. So this highlighted part, guys, used to be immediately after 20. Aha! The satanic verses. The famous satanic verses that Muhammad delivered to the pagan of Quraysh. Do you see it? This is not my own words. These are your books. These are your mufassirun. Don't shoot the messenger. So when the Quraysh, guys, let me continue. When the Quraysh heard this, they were really happy with Muhammad. Thank you, Muhammad. Thank you. Thank you for saying really beautiful stuff about our gods. Allat al-Uzza wal-Manat, the third, right? So here, Muhammad started to associate partners with Allah. What did you say, Rob Christian? Muhammad started to associate partners with Allah. Allat al-Uzza wal-Manat. Do you see it? He's saying, these are the mighty cranes. And their intercession is hopeful. So Muhammad here became, again, a nice pagan mushrik boy. And when the Quraysh, as we just mentioned, when they heard this, they were really pleased with Muhammad. Thank you, Muhammad. Thank you for becoming a nice pagan boy with us. Ya mushrik Muhammad. Muhammad, you mushrik, son of a mushrik. We know that Abdullah and Amina were mushrikeen. But now their son, the so-called prophet of Islam, became a mushrik too. Uh-oh. Do we have any Muslim? You are ignorant. Even Ibn Kathir said it's fabricated. Really? How? Call me and say to my face that it's fabricated. Call me. Call me, Ya Abdul. Call me. Never? Oh, you're never going to call me because you're a coward son of Gawad Jaban Ibn Jaban, like your father. You are a Jaban Ibn Jaban. Right? That's why. So the messenger of Allah bless him and give him peace, carried on reciting until the end of the surah, and then he prostrated. Right? He started to what? Prostrate, did sujood. All the Muslims followed suit and prostrated, including the Muslims who were there. Let's say if Abu Bakr was there, Aisha was there, Umar was there, they all became mushrikeen together with Muhammad. So not only Muhammad, the Sahaba became mushrikeen. All the Muslims. The Sahaba became mushrikeen together with Muhammad. I'm so scared, brother. This is why I'm doing a live show, brother, and my Skype is open, brother. Look how scared I am, brother. You see, my Skype is open and I am the scared one, guys. Did you catch it? You see the logic of Muslims? Brother, you're scared, brother. Thank you. I'm very good, Brainiac. I hope you're doing fine, too. Today, guys, it's the janazah of the Prophet of Islam. You know, what's the janazah? That's the funeral. Whenever Muslims debate Christians and they think they are winning the debate, they say, it's janazah. Janazah, akhi. Well, let's see who's the janazah is today for you, for your prophet. So all the Muslims started to do sujood, prostrating. That's an act of worship, by the way. And all the pagans, the idolaters who were present there, they prostrated too because they actually believed that Muhammad delivered to them the satanic verses. The unforgivable sin. Yes, here Muhammad became a mushrik. Muhammad became a mushrik. When we ask Muslim, is shirk forgiving? Forgiving by Allah? No, brother. Shirk is unforgivable sin. So clearly, Allah cannot forgive Muhammad and the Muslims, the first generation of Muslims, all the Muslims who were present, Allah will not forgive them. Brother, what are you saying, brother? The Sahaba are mushrikeen? Yes, brother. Including the Prophet. So all those who were present, whether Muslim or disbeliever, prostrated, except two old gentlemen, because they were too old and could not prostrate. So they could not bow down, act of worship, towards Allah Al-Uzza wal Manat. And instead, they both grabbed a handful of dust and put their foreheads on. You know that it's as if they are bowing down, guys. Because these are two very old guys. So the Quraysh, if we continue reading, the Quraysh then went away. They dispersed, happy with what they heard from Muhammad. How can you contact me? By calling me. Are you a Muslim, Praniac? You can call me live on Skype. My Skype ID is D-Rob Christian. For now, only Muslims can call me, guys. If you're a Christian, please don't call me, okay? If you're a Christian, don't call me yet. Let's see if Muslims will call us. I mean, we are live. Call me, man. We are live. If you're a Muslim, you think you have the courage and the knowledge to refute me, call me. And then the pagans, look what the pagans are saying, guys. Muhammad, the Prophet of Islam, has mentioned our idols with complimentary terms. So do you see? The pagans of Quraysh, the own tribe of Muhammad, their his own family, right? They were really happy with Muhammad because he was saying really beautiful stuff about their idols, right? He mentioned our idols with complimentary terms. They were at this very moment really pleased with the pagan Muhammad, associating partners with Allah, like the pagans used to do. Actually, guys, if you are with me, please give me one if you are with me. The pagans of Quraysh, guys, the pagans of Quraysh in Mecca used to worship Allah, Allat, Al-Uzza, Wal-Manat, and Akbar, the wife of Allah, the sun. Allah was the moon idol, Akbar was the sun, his wife, and he had daughters from her, Allat, Al-Uzza, Wal-Manat. So actually, the pagans used to worship Allah, right? As the supreme moon idol. He was the supreme moon idol of the pagan Quraysh. Allah was nothing new, guys. Muhammad did not bring anything new, including the Allah, the pagan Allah. Did you catch it? Allah was the pagan idol, the moon idol of the pagans. And he had daughters. Right? He had daughters, Allat al-Uzza wal-Manat. And they are actually high cranes. They are bird. You know what cranes are, guys? They were bird idols. Let me show you what kind of bird idols they used to be. This is a crane, guys. Let me show you. For the people who do not know. You see, those are crane birds. So this is how they actually looked like. Big birds, yeah. You see it? Very big birds with large legs. You see, they put their legs in the water. You see it? So the bird idols of the pagan Quraysh and Muhammad bowed down to them. Why are they called bird idols, guys? Why are they called cranes? Because they have wings. Do you see? They can fly. And actually, when the pagan of Quraysh used to pray to Allah, the supreme moon idol of the pagan Quraysh, these bird idols used to carry, fly, and carry the prayers of the pagan Quraysh all the way to the moon idol Allah. So they carried the prayers, and with their wings, they could fly all the way to Allah to deliver the prayers of the pagans. This is how the pagans of Quraysh used to believe, how their prayers used to be delivered through a message delivery system by the birds. So these birds are actually partners with Allah, they work for Allah, and they put their prayers on their backs or whatever, and they flew all the way to Allah to deliver the prayers, the messages of the pagan Quraysh. Did you catch it, guys? Are you still with me? So these are the high cranes. The high cranes, guys. Do you see it? These are the mighty cranes, and their intercession is hoped for. These are Al-Lat, Al-Uzza, Wal-Manat. تلك الغرانيق العلا إن شفاعتهن لترتجى. Did you catch it? These are the satanic verses. This highlighted part for the people who just joined. So whenever a Muslim, you have a debate with a Muslim, these are the satanic verses, guys. Let me give you the link again for the people who just joined. Help me to help you. Bookmark these links. Save them. Help me to help you. Use them in your debates. Did you catch it? So these are the mighty cranes. Al-Lat, Al-Uzza, Al-Manat. The bird idols, the daughters of Allah. I think, guys, Allah looks like a bird. Because, I mean, if his daughters look like a bird, now we can understand how Allah has two right hands. He looks like a bird because his daughters look like a bird. Right? Allah is a funny God, man, in Islam. So let's see what happened. After this disaster, after Muhammad became a mushrik boy, and Allah will not forgive him anymore for doing this, shirk. Right? And he bowed down to Al-Lat, Al-Uzza, Al-Manat. Let's see what happened. After the Quraysh, they were dispersed. They went away and saying, hey, Muhammad, really? Muhammad, you did an amazing job, Muhammad. Thank you, Muhammad, for saying beautiful stuff about our idols. Right? And they say, we know that Allah, see guys, they actually worshipped Allah. Allah is nothing new. Do you see what the pagans are saying? We know, so quote unquote, here the pagans are speaking. We know that Allah gives life. The supreme moon idol, Allah, gives life and takes it away. He creates and provides substance. But these idols of ours, do you see it? These idols of ours, Al-Lat, Al-Uzza, Al-Manat, will intercede for us with him. Bam! Do you see it, guys? Do you see that Allah actually existed before Islam? And the pagans of Quraysh used to worship Allah. And these bird idols, the high cranes, the mighty cranes, used to live. They had a delivery system, delivering mail in the form of prayers all the way to the supreme moon idol of the pagans, Allah. Did you catch it? Now that Muhammad has associated them, what? Muhammad has associated Al-Lat, Al-Uzza, Al-Manat, we are all with him. So Muhammad became a nice mushrik boy. You boy, you pagan boy, Muhammad, you prophet. You pagan prophet. Yeah, Allah's DHL, exactly, delivery system, mail delivery system. For prayers. Muhammad, he became really a good mushrik boy, brother. Mashallah, brother. That evening, guys, after Muhammad became a nice mushrik boy, and he delivered the satanic verses, and he bowed down, did sujood to Al-Lat, Al-Uzza, Al-Manat, that evening, Jibreel, the angel Jibreel came, and went to Muhammad. Do you see it? And said, now here Jibreel is talking, guys. Pay attention. Jibreel is the one talking now. What have you done, Muhammad? Jibreel is saying. Oh. So Jibreel started to spank Muhammad. Spank, spank, Muhammad. Muhammad, what have you done, Muhammad? Spank, spank. What have you done? You recited to the people, to the Quraysh and the Muslims, everyone who was there, that which I did not bring from Allah. Yeah, Jibreel was really upset for Muhammad. He was really upset for Muhammad associating partners with Allah. So Jibreel started to spank Muhammad and said, and you said what I did not say to you. So Jibreel saying, what have you done, man? That's not what I said to you. That's Satan talking. Right? Satan is the one talking, not me. Do you see it? The devil put on his tongue what he had secretly wished and say, تِلْكَ الْغُرَانِيقَ الْعُلَىٰ إِنَّ شَفَعَتَهُنَّ لَتُرْتَجَىٰ. Why, Muhammad? Why? Why did you become a mushrik boy? What have you done, man? Jibreel is saying, I didn't give you these satanic verses. These are not the words of Allah. Now ask yourself this, if there are any Muslims here, why is Allah allowing Satan to come in between and destroy the Quran of Allah? Why is Allah silent, allowing Muhammad to become a mushrik boy, a pagan boy? Why is Allah not helping his prophet before it's happening? Mushrik, dumb. It's mushrik with an R, mushrik, which means as an associator of partners of with Allah. So you become a pagan, basically. You are associating partners with Allah. And that's the unforgivable sin in Islam. So is Muhammad, guys, is Muhammad a sinner? Oh boy, yes he is. And we just proved it to you, right? We just proved it to you. You see it? So seer Jibreel started to spank Muhammad. What have you done, Muhammad? Muhammad, what have you done, man? Jibreel is saying, look how he's pointing fingers at Muhammad. This is supposedly Muhammad and this is Jibreel. Do you see it? What have you done, man? Spank, man. Yeah, so Muhammad did the unforgivable sin. Muhammad became a mushrik. Bam on your faces, Muslims. Either you're going to leave Islam after today's live show, or you're going to stay a nice pagan mushrik together with your mushrik prophet. Yeah, and you see, Jibreel is using his left hand. Exactly, yeah. Jibreel, come on, man. Don't you know that it's haram to use the right hand, man? When you eat, you need to use your right hand. So why are you using your left hand? Anyway, let it go. Guys, let's see about how Muhammad actually was visited from the devil himself called Al-Abyad. Do you see it? Prophet Muhammad and the devil named Al-Abyad. So Muhammad was actually getting satanic revelation. He was getting satanic revelation, and this devil has a name. So actually, this is, you know, when picture this, guys, this creature that you see here, he looks like Jibreel, but it's not Jibreel. It's Al-Abyad coming to Muhammad in the shape of Jibreel. Are you saying that this devil Al-Abyad can shapeshift and look like Jibreel? Yes, brother. Guys, are you actually getting what I'm saying here? Yeah, Al-Abyad means the white one. Al-Abyad, that's the name of the devil. Al-Abyad, right? Means the white one. The white one. Okay? That's the name of this devil that looks like Jibreel. Because Muhammad actually believed it's Jibreel giving him the satanic verses. He didn't know it's the devil, right? So the devil in Islam can shapeshift and look like Jibreel, and he has a name, the white one, Al-Abyad. Did you catch it? Guys, let me give you the link so you can read with me and bookmark it, guys. Bookmark this. Here's the link. Okay? Here's the link. Now let us do some investigation, guys. Let me scroll down. Let me scroll down. The odd narratives mentioning Al-Abyad come under three verses. As we mentioned, chapter 22, guys, ayah 52. We just mentioned that, right, guys? And the tafsir for it. You see? This is Al-Abyad who came to Muhammad and gave him the satanic verses. Chapter 22, ayah 52, tafsir. Do you see it? So, it's mentioned in chapter 22, ayah 52. It's mentioned in ayah 16 of chapter 59, And it's also mentioned in chapter 81, ayah 25. So in three different places, guys, in the Quran, we see Al-Abyad doing his work for Muhammad. Muhammad was not visited once. He was not visited twice, but thrice, three times. Yeah, the white devil, exactly, the white one. Al-Abyad. You see, he looks like this, like Jibreel, exactly like Jibreel. And he is white, the white one. Everything in Islam is white, guys. Okay, I can give you the link again, guys. Let me give you the link again for the people who just came to the live show. Bookmark it, save them. Guys, please invite your friends. Invite your friends. Don't forget to subscribe. Please smash that like button. Destroy it. Destroy it as it is demon-possessed like Muhammad. Destroy that like button and click on the notification bell to receive notifications when we go live, like today. Someone called me. I missed the call. Why is my Skype sometimes doing this? Let me close Skype. Something is really strange happening to my Skype. Let me reopen it again. I have no clue why this is happening. Maybe I need to reinstall Skype. I don't know. Let me try to call this good Abdul. Let's see who this guy is. Pick up, Abdul. Pick up. This is the guy who called me. I think it's a troll. He called me like 9 minutes ago. What about this guy? This is the guy who's stalking me on Facebook with his stealing Wi-Fi. Let's give him a chance, guys. Abdul, pick up. I think his Wi-Fi is not working. Let me try again. This guy is so smart. He called me before I went live, guys. Can you imagine? He called me before I went live today. You see? Missed call. He called me at 4:20 p.m. Anyway. Smart Abduls, man. Really smart Abduls. Anyway, let's see if they are going to call me back again. So, let me continue, guys. Let me go back. So, Al-Abyad, the Satan Al-Abyad, the white one, Al-Abyad, visited Muhammad three times. And you can find this in chapter 22, ayah 52, chapter 59, ayah 16, and chapter 81, ayah 25. And he exactly looked like Jibreel. Do you see it? He's a shapeshifter. Al-Abyad is a shapeshifter. So he can shapeshift, he can change his look, and he can look like who? Jibreel. Right? He can change his shape. And Muhammad was fooled three times, not just one time. Three times, brother? Yes, brother, three times. Three times. So guys, let us continue and make it even more worse before Muslims start to call us liars and say, this is fabrication, brother. No, brother, it's not fabrication. Let us spank your prophet even more. In connection with chapter 22, in the ayah 52, though Al-Sam'ani, and here is the reference, also made a passing remark about reports suggesting Al-Abyad coming to the Prophet. Do you see it? And telling him the infamous satanic verses. As we mentioned, Muhammad bowing down and becoming a mushrik boy in Mecca. So guys, this is in Mecca. Remember, this is in Mecca. Right? He's in Mecca. The first to give a detailed account of Al-Abyad, the Satan called Al-Abyad, the devil himself, in this context was Al-Razi. One of the granddaddies of Tafsir. He's a huge, huge Mufassir in Islam. Al-Razi, a huge old school daddy for tafsir, a mufassir, very famous, very respected, who records that. I'm not going to read the Arabic for you. Let me go immediately to the English translation. So Al-Razi, this is Al-Razi reporting it, guys. Al-Razi. This is not Rab Kishin, this is Al-Razi. Reporting for chapter 22, ayah 52. Let me scroll back for the people just. This is Al-Razi's work, reporting for chapter 22, ayah 52. It is reported from Atta that Ibn Abbas. Ibn Abbas is, who is Ibn Abbas, guys? Anyone? Who is Ibn Abbas? People, who is Ibn Abbas? Anyone? Anyone has an idea who Ibn Abbas is, guys? In Islam? Yeah, Muhammad's cousin. Thank you, Phil Huraira. He's a Sahabi. He's even the cousin of Muhammad. The cousin of Muhammad, brother? Yes. The cousin of Muhammad said, Ibn Abbas, the cousin of Muhammad said, a devil called Al-Abiyad came to the Prophet. And this is the report of Al-Razi for Ibn Abbas saying, the devil, Al-Abiyad, the white one, brother? Yes, the white one, Al-Abiyad, came to the Prophet in the form of Jibreel. Salamu alayka ya Muhammad, says Al-Abiyad, in the form of Jibreel. So Muhammad did not know that this is actually not Jibreel. Did you catch it? Yeah, the cousin of Muhammad, Ibn Abbas, saying this. Do you see it? So the shapeshifter, the devil, Al-Abiyad, he came in the form of Jibreel, Gabriel, in Islam. So Muhammad actually thought this is Jibreel and caused these words, i.e., the satanic verses. تِلْكَ الْغَرَانِيقَ الْعُلَىٰ إِنَّ شَفَاعَتَهُنَّ لَتُرْتَجَىٰ. But brother, this is a fabrication, brother. No, brother. This is Al-Razi from the mouth of Ibn Abbas reporting it. Right? So the satanic, Muhammad delivered the satanic verses, as we mentioned earlier, to the pagan Quraysh and the Muslims. Everyone who was sitting there listening to Muhammad. And they all bowed down and committed shirk. When the pagans heard that, it pleased them. They were really happy with Muhammad. Oh my Allah! Muhammad, you are giving the pagan Quraysh satanic verses. And you are being fooled by the devil himself, by Al-Abiyad, who came to you in the form of Jibreel? Yes, brother. Muslims, you need to wake up. Your prophet became a nice, mushrik, pagan boy. Thereupon, Jibreel came and asked him to rehearse. The real Jibreel, guys. Let the real Jibreel please stand up. I'm here, brother. Hello, I'm Jibreel. So Jibreel, the real Jibreel, not Al-Abiyad this time. The real Jibreel, after the damage is done, after Muhammad made a huge damage, a disaster, and he fooled himself, and he fooled everybody, including the Muslims and the pagans, then Jibreel suddenly pops out. Kapow! It's me, Jibreel! The real Jibreel. He came and asked Muhammad to recite the revelation to him. So Jibreel here is doing a test for Muhammad. Muhammad is putting to the test by Jibreel, the real Jibreel. When he reached those words, which were the satanic verses, right? I.e., the satanic verses. Jibreel says, the real Jibreel says, I did not bring you these words, Muhammad. It wasn't me, it was Al-Abiyad who came in my form as Jibreel. He was the fake Jibreel. So the real Jibreel says, spanking Muhammad, I did not bring you these words, i.e. the satanic verses. Someone came to me in your form and caused these words on my tongue. So Muhammad is saying, someone else came to me in your form, Muhammad's reaction is, and cast these satanic verses on my tongue. Where is Muhammad's Allah to help him out? Just a mistake, brother. Brother, associating partners with Allah is a mistake, brother. Muhammad never committed any sin, brother, says the Sheikh, brother. Sheikh, ya Sheikhi Sheikh, Muhammad Salih al-Munajjid. You said, and I quote, quote unquote, Muhammad, including all the messengers, never committed any sin. Really? Brother, really? Are you for real? We just spanked you again. We just barbecued you again. And your prophet. Did you catch it? Yeah, that wasn't me. That was the transformer Al-Abyad, the shapeshifter Al-Abyad devil. Right? So this is the devil who came and shapeshifted, transformed into Jibreel, delivering him the satanic verses. So this is incident number one. Guys, take notes. This is incident number one. What incident? This is chapter 22, I 52. This is number one, right, guys? Incident number one. And we told you there are three incidents in the life of Muhammad. You can find the satanic verses over and over, over and over, all through the Quran. Three incidents. Three, brother, not just one, brother, no, three. That was number one. Let us see. Let us go to Quran chapter 59, ayah 16. Point number two. Incident number two. Shirk number two. Lord have mercy. Impossible. Yes, brother. It's the impossible became the possible in Islam. Brother, Muhammad being a mushrik for the second time. Yes, brother. As for the Quran, chapter 59, ayah 16, it is related as a parenthetic line in an unusual long story of Israelite, a cystic named Barsisa lured by Al-Abyad as a special assignment from the chief devil Iblis. Al-Qurtubi writes, Al-Abyad, he was the companion of the prophets. What? Companion of the prophets, brother? All the prophets? Yes, brother. Oh, my. So, guys, you see what's happening here, guys? Guys, do you understand what is happening? Because Muhammad was busted delivering satanic verses, now the Mufassirun are actually lying about all the prophets. Including Moses, brother? Yes, Moses too. Abraham too. All the prophets. Yeah, he was the Sahabi, the companion, the Al-Abyad devil, right? The devil Al-Abyad, the devil. You see the beautiful horns of Al-Abyad. You see his horns? So Al-Abyad, brother, for the second time in the Quran, this is chapter 59, ayah 16, he was again the companion of all the prophets and the one who intended to reach the prophet. Who? Muhammad. Do you see it? You see it, baby. Yeah. In the form of Jibreel. Again, the fake Jibreel, Al-Abyad, the Satan, came to whisper to Muhammad satanic verses again. Then the real Jibreel intervened and pushed Al-Abyad with his hand, throwing him to the farthest corner of India. Brother, India, brother? Yes. Brother, let me give you an advice. Everyone who lives in India, to the Indians in India, I advise you to leave the country immediately, ASAP. Yeah. Al-Abyad now is living in India, brother. So my advice to the people from India, leave the country immediately, brother. Yeah, all the 124,000 prophets in Islam were accompanied by the devil Abyad. Indians, leave the country immediately because among you lives the devil Al-Abyad. Leave the country immediately, brother. Evacuate, brother. Sarah, take a wild guess who was squeezing Muhammad in that cave. I think it was the fake Jibreel, brother. اقرا اقرا. Al-Abyad is saying, اقرا اقرا. It is Al-Abyad. No one, you know, Muhammad himself, his first feeling, he said, this is a demon who touched me. Muhammad saying, go to Sirah al-Nabawiyyah. Go and see for yourself that Muhammad, his first feeling was, quote unquote, it was a demon who touched me. I don't know why India, I don't know. Pick and choose, brother. You tell me. So Al-Abyad lives in India, guys. Al-Abyad was pushed by the real Jibreel to India. So this is point number two, incident number two. Let us go to incident number three. Chapter 81, ayah 25. In commentary to verse 25 from chapter 81, Muqatil bin Sulaiman notes, incident number three. When the Prophet, who Muhammad was sent, Iblis said, who is for this Prophet who has emerged from the land of Tihama? And a shaitan called Al-Abyad, who was the companion of the Prophets, i.e. Muhammad, Sahib al-Anbiya. In Arabic, you call that Sahib al-Anbiya, right? So all the companions, sorry, all the prophets was being accompanied by the devil Al-Abyad. You see how guys, you see how in Islam, all the prophets are actually the fake prophets. All the prophets, they had a Sahabi, a Sahib, and he is called Sahib al-Anbiya, Al-Abyad devil, Shaitan. He's Shaitan, man. You see it? Said, I and for him. So he came to the Prophet Muhammad. Again, the shapeshifter Satan, Shaitan, the demon, Al-Abyad, coming to Muhammad again for the third time and found him in the house of Al-Safa. Did you catch it? Take a screenshot. Third time again, yeah. When he, the Prophet, turned, Al-Abyad stood up in the form of Jibreel. Wow! Bam! Let it sink in, Muslims. Take a sip. Eat it. Don't forget to digest it. Swallow it, but don't forget to digest it. I know, this is damaging. Muhammad didn't sin, brother. No, Muhammad actually sinned, brother. And he delivered the satanic over and over and over. He delivered the satanic verses over and over and over and over and over. At least three times he was visited by Shaitan al-Abyad in the form of Jibreel to communicate. To who? To Muhammad. So Jibreel came down. The real Jibreel. Let the real Jibreel please stand up. Let the real Jibreel please stand up. Here I am, brother. I'm Jibreel, brother. The real one, brother. Not the fake one. So Jibreel came down and put his hand between him and the Prophet. Between who? Al-Abyad. Right? Between Al-Abyad and him, Al-Abyad and the Prophet, Jibreel comes in between and started to push Al-Abyad gently. Why gently, brother? Your Prophet is being humiliated. Your Prophet is being under influence of Al-Abyad Shaitan and you're pushing him gently, brother? Just gently, brother? By this, he was thrust away from Mecca. So this happened in Mecca, guys. When Muhammad was in Mecca still and landed in the farthest parts of India. Again, to the people of India, leave the country immediately. Immediately. Leave it. Evacuate the country. To the leaders of India. Mayday, mayday. Brother, leave India immediately. ASAP, because among you, a shaitan, Al-Abyad, is living. And he's now in India, brother. Did you catch it, brother? Brother, this is all fake, brother. Brother, this is all fabricated, brother. No, brother, this is not fabricated, brother. This is from your highest sources. Like Al-Razi, Ibn Abbas, Al-Tabari, and so on. And so on, and so on, brother. Lord have mercy. And I can continue and continue on this matter. Now, Muslims, guys, here is the reaction of the Muslims. Pay attention, guys. Now you need to learn how to react to Muslims who are trying their best. You know, they are bankrupt, right, guys? You know, Muslims are bankrupt, but they always try to refute our teaching, right? They refute us in our debates. Guys, take your pens out. Let me teach you how to refute their so-called refutation. They cannot refute it. They know it's true, but they try, right? They try to defend their prophet. Unbelievable, brother. Yes, Lichu. Can the real angel please stand up? Guys, you really need to download our video today because this video is a huge damage to the Prophet of Islam. Take notes. Guys, when we mention this topic to Muslims in our debates, they immediately go to Sahih al-Bukhari. This is Sahih al-Bukhari. Let me give you the link. And they say, brother, Sahih al-Bukhari refutes this incident, brother. This is fabricated, brother. Why, brother? Because it's the same Ibn Abbas in Sahih al-Bukhari, brother, narrating the following. This is Sahih al-Bukhari, hadith number 38.5. Sorry, 38.5, yeah. 38.5. 385. So I gave you the link, the reference. Let me read it for you. The Prophet performed a prostration when he finished reciting Surah An-Najm. We already know that. Okay, what's new? And all the Muslims and all the pagans and jinns and human being prostrated along with him. Where's the refutation, brother? Do you see any refutation, you guys? Where's the refutation, brother? Here, brother, here. Where? Guys, can you show me the refutation? I'll give you $1,000 if you can show me the refutation. Well, brother, it says, you know why this is a refutation, brother Rob Christian? Why? Because it says the Prophet performed a prostration, so he did sujood when he finished reciting Surah An-Najm. Aha, okay. When is Surah An-Najm, guys? When was Surah An-Najm delivered? Can someone tell me? When did it happen? When and where? Brother, when did this happen? Where was Muhammad when he was delivering to his people Surah An-Najm? Anyone? This is a question to the Muslims and the people who are listening. When did Muhammad deliver chapter 53? This is chapter 53, guys, of the Quran, right? This is chapter 53, right? So according to this hadith, when Muhammad finished reciting the entire surah, so when he finished reciting the last ayah, he bowed down, right? As the hadith says. So when he finished it, when he finished reciting chapter 53, Surah An-Najm, then all the Muslims and pagans and jinns and human beings prostrate along with him. Guys, where was he? Where was Muhammad when he delivered this surah to the people? Couple of people are saying Mecca. Don Mitchell saying Medina. Which one is it? Is it Mecca or Medina? Give me your final answer. Did this happen in Mecca or Medina, guys? Come on. What is the majority vote, guys? Answer my call. Mecca? You're not calling me, Abdul. Are you the good Abdul? I just called you earlier. I'm calling you, Abdul. I'm calling you. Pick up. Are you this guy?
Hey, Rob.
Hello. Welcome.
Hello.
Hello.
Hey, Rob. How are you?
I'm good, my friend. How are you?
Yeah, I'm doing good. What's up?
I'm good. Are you a Muslim or a Christian, my friend?
Yes, I am a Muslim.
You're a Muslim, okay.
Right.
Okay. Go ahead, my friend.
So, I'm sure you wouldn't remember me because a lot of people call you, but we spoke just maybe last week, and you hung up on me unfairly.
Okay.
So I think maybe you might do the same here, because every time you come to a dead end, you like to hang up.
No. We hang up on only people who are actually liars. I can't simply, I'm a person, if you understand what I'm doing, I'm a person who cannot accept lies and allow anyone, including Christians, not only Muslims. If you're a Christian and you lie, I will hang up on you. I don't like to talk to liars. So this is why I hung up on you last time.
Appreciate that. Very okay. nice. Appreciate okay. that.
So you but called us. You called me about today's teaching about Muhammed being a pagan mushrik.
Yes, of course. I called you to talk about what you're talking about, which is the satanic verses.
Yes. This happened in the life of Muhammad. Yes or no?
Of course, anything that happens in the life of the Prophet Muhammad, or anything that happens in history, we have to always verify the source.
Okay.
So this incident is obviously from a Mursal source, which is not a strong source. Neither the six books of Hadith, neither Ibn Hisham, neither Ibn Ishaq, the two major seerahs, they don't mention this incident. It's not found in any of the eight authentic books.
It's Sahih al-Bukhari here.
Oh, hang on. We are first discussing about the satanic verses.
Yeah, this is the satanic verses. It's in front of you.
No, it's not. It doesn't say that.
Okay, go ahead. Refute me on it. It's in front of you.
Yes, it is in front of me, but...
Can you read it, please?
Yes, narrated by Ibn Abbas that the Prophet ﷺ performed prostration when he finished reciting Surah An-Najm, and all the Muslims and pagans and jinns and human beings prostrated along with him.
Okay, when did this happen?
This happened in the fifth year of Mecca.
So it's in Mecca, right?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Guys, he said it. It's in Mecca. So the answer, because I asked this question to the audience who are listening in the chat, when did this happen? Where? In Mecca. Thank you. And you just confirmed it. Now, my question to you, does it say that all the Muslims and the pagans bowed down and prostrated with Muhammad?
Yes, of course, it does
okay.
say that, yes.
Okay. Did the right. pagan of Quraysh, did they persecute Muhammad? And did Muhammad flee Mecca? And why?
After a few more years, about... 7 to 8 years more of living in Mecca, and then he fled. Yes.
Yeah. And the pagans of Mecca rejected Muhammad, and he had to flee. Right.
Very correct. Yes. Yes.
Thank you. So how guys? Here's the question: how are the pagans bowing down if they rejected Muhammad? Go ahead.
Okay. So, of course, I'm sure your audiences may not be as educated as you are, and I'm presuming you are, and you would know that the.
Go ahead.
Connected to the Muslims, easily they were, I'm sorry, not the Muslims, the Mushrikeen, the Quraysh.
Yeah.
They accepted the message of Islam just by listening to the Quran.
Who?
Right?
Which pagans accepted Muhammad in Mecca? Who? The pagans were persecuting, when we ask Muslims, you Muslims say that the pagans always persecuted for Muhammad. They rejected him. Even his uncle rejected him. And you always call his uncle all kind of names, Abu Lahab, right? May he burn. So even his own family rejected it. And his uncle was a pagan.
You cannot put a blanket statement. His uncle Hamza accepted him.
Couple of people. Only a couple of people accepted him.
Yeah.
What about the rest? It says, and the pagans. The pagans bow down. It's talking about all the pagans, all the Muslims. Do you see?
It says all the Muslims and
the pagans and the jinns. It's talking about everyone. Do you see it? It says all.
Right.
Who
Agreed.
Is all?
Yes.
So all the pagans. But wait a second. You Muslims always say Muhammad was being persecuted in Mecca. This is why he flee Mecca. He did hijrah to Medina. Right. So you just confirmed that the satanic verses are actually an historical event
in the life
of Muhammad. Muhammad became a pagan mushrik.
No, that's what you are extrapolating.
How? Does it say all the pagans in front of you?
If you listen to the Surah An-Najm, which is 62 verses, After the verses which you mentioned is where the taking of the tree, Allah, after this, if you look at the verses from 21 onwards.
I understand that he started to prostrate after he finished Surah An-Najm, which is chapter 53. I understand that. I already read it from multiple sources. But it says all the Muslims and all the pagans and all the jinns and all human beings prostrated along with him. Does it say that?
Yes, it says that. Okay, but
the pagans rejected him.
Of course, they rejected him throughout the course of the...
Get lost. You know you're a bastard. Guys, come on, man. The pagans rejected him, but they bowed down, right? Makes sense. You see, guys, how easy it is to refute it? You see how easy it is to refute it? All the Muslims, all the pagans, and all jinns and human beings prostrated along. Why? Because he delivered the satanic verses. You can do all kind of mental gymnastics, but you know, the pagans would never ever, all the pagans, right? All the Muslims and all the pagans will never ever bow down if Muhammad was attacking their idols. No, the pagans were really happy, and this is why they bowed down, right? This is why they bowed down, because Muhammad was saying beautiful stuff about their idols. Why would the pagans bow down, right, guys? No, angels, unicorn, Aaron. Last time, this is why I hung up on him, and today I'm hanging up on him, because I don't like to spank the same kid over and over. It's in front of everybody, all the Muslims, all the pagans, right? All the pagans bow down. Why would pagans, who were his enemies, bow down? Because clearly this is talking about the satanic verses. Muhammad delivered the satanic verses, and he bowed down to Allat al-Uzza wal-Manat and said, "Thilka al-gharaniq al-ula, inna shafa'atahunna la turtaj." So actually, Sahih al-Bukhari, that Muslims love to go to, this is actually a huge weapon against Muhammad. Don't ever go to this hadith. Let me give you the hadith again, guys, because this destroys Muhammad even more. Because this is saying all the Muslims, all the pagans, and everybody else prostrated, did sujood to who? Allat al-Uzza wal-Manat. So why are you Muslims going to Sahih al-Bukhari? This makes it even more worse. It says all the Muslims, all the pagans, all the jinns, and all human beings prostrated along with him. Yeah, Moses actually would smack Muhammad around with a rock and would have stoned Muhammad to death for being a pagan. Right? Do you see it, guys? All the pagans. Wait, pagans were happy with Muhammad, right? As we showed you. Right? The pagans were happy with Muhammad. When the Quraysh pagans heard this, they were really happy with Muhammad. Why? Because he said, "Thilka al-gharaniq al-ula, Allat al-Uzza wal-Manat." These are the mighty cranes. "Inna shafa'atahunna." Their intercession is hoped for. La turtaja. Bam! This is why the pagans bowed down. This is why all the pagans bowed down. So never ever, Muslims who are listening, never ever go to Sahih al-Bukhari. Yeah. This is the question, why all the pagans are bowing down. When we ask Muslims, guys, think with me. When we ask Muslims, when Muhammad was in Mecca, was he being persecuted by the pagans? Yes, brother, he was. This is why he fled to Medina. This is why he did hijrah, right? Migration to Medina. Because he was getting persecuted for attacking the idols of Mecca. Attacking the idols of Mecca, the pagans of Mecca, right? But here, at this very incident, Muhammad became a pagan. But when Jibril came, right? Jibreel came, the real Jibreel. May the real Jibreel please stand up. Muhammad, he's pointing fingers at Muhammad. Muhammad, what have you done? This is not me delivering you the satanic verses. This was the devil. What have you done, Muhammad? Do you see it? After he finished reciting the entire chapter, right? After he finished reciting the chapter, he carried on reciting until the end of the surah, chapter 53, as we mentioned. Then he bowed down. All the Muslims followed suit and proud. This is copy-paste. Do you see it, guys? This part, guys. This part, do you see it? Actually, Sahih al-Bukhari is copy-paste. Do you see it? Copy-paste. This part is same as this part. Do you see it? Everyone, including the pagans, including all the humans who were there, all of them bowed down. Why? Because Muhammad bowed down, and they bowed down together with him to Allah al-Uzza wal-Manat after reciting the satanic verses, this part. And where could we find this part? It was usually immediately after ayah 20, right here. As we mentioned, here after this ayah 20, chapter 53, ayah 20, the satanic verses were dropped down. So it's a copy paste, actually, right? This part is copy paste or in Sahih al-Bukhari. So Muslims, don't ever go to Sahih al-Bukhari to try to refute us. You see how Muslims are in trouble, guys? But brother, this is fabricated, brother. No, this is not fabricated, brother, because the same is reported in Sahih al-Bukhari. Guys, did you catch it? Did you catch it? Guys, I'm gonna be right back. Give me a couple of seconds. I'm going to grab some water because my throat is itching. Be right back. Okay, guys, sorry for that. So now and then we need to grab some water because how long are we live, guys? Almost 2 hours. Okay. Let me drink something. So guys, as you see, all the Muslims, all the pagans, everyone who was there, and all the jinns and human beings prostrated along with Muhammad. Why? Because the pagans also, who were present, accepted the fact that Muhammad said complimentary stuff about their idols. And all of them bowed down. Then Jibreel comes and says, may the real Jibreel please stand up. You recite to the people that which I do not bring from Allah. Glorified is Allah. And you said what I did not say to you. Spank, spank, Muhammad, said Jibreel to Muhammad. Sean K, RC, what's the price on your head for busting Muhammad? I don't know, bro. This topic, someone's saying this topic is great. Well, it's my pleasure to spank the Prophet of Islam. Bam, exactly. I thought jinn were invisible. Yes, radioactive. It does not say that they are visible. So the invisible jinns also bow down. Why would jinn bow down, guys? Why would jinn bow down? Why would the pagans bow down, right? all the pagans, all the jinns bow down. Because simply Muhammad delivered the satanic verses and he started to prostrate. Act of worship, right? Prostration, act of worship towards Allah al-Azza wal-Manat. So today, guys, we prove to you that Muhammad actually committed horrible sins, horrendous sins. And the most worst one is associating partners with Allah, which is unforgivable sin, shirk, the unforgivable sin in Islam. So Allah cannot forgive Muhammad. Guys, to prove it to you, why Rob Christian can spank Muhammad? Why? Guys, does it make sense? When we ask Muslims, guys, when we ask Muslims, did the pagan of Quraysh, the pagan Quraysh of Mecca, did they accept Muhammad? No, they were persecuting Muhammad, right? And as you see, the proof is in front of you. So the Surah An-Najm, right? Chapter 53, Surah An-Najm was delivered in Mecca. This is the chronological order, right? Let me scroll back. You see, this is the chronological order, the traditional order of the Quran, how it's supposedly came down, right? Actually, Surah Al-Alaq was normally the first chapter, as you see, right? Iqra fi ismi rabbika, right? Illi khalaq. So, Iqra, read or recite, right? That was normally the first chapter. Surah Al-Alaq. So the real order, or the traditional canonical order for chapter 53 is 23. Do you see it? And it's in Mecca. What did you say, Rob Christian? And you heard the Muslim gentleman, right? You heard the Muslim gentleman saying this happened in Mecca. So he was correct. So guys, think with me here. Muhammad is being persecuted for 10 years in Mecca. 10 years in Mecca. The pagans did not accept him. No, only a small group, right? Like Abu Bakr, like his, you know, couple of them. Even his two uncles did not accept him as his prophet, as prophet. Abu Lahab was his uncle, right? Last time we mentioned when Muhammad was being sexually abused by his other uncle, that uncle did not accept him as a prophet. Two uncles did not accept him. And they were pagans. You see how easy it is to spank Muslims. So they were in Mecca, right? Muhammad was in Mecca. So why would all the pagans of Mecca bow down? Because Muhammad was saying beautiful stuff about their idols and he delivered them the satanic verses. Thank you, Muhammad, the pagans are saying. So actually, this hadith is actually very, very bad for you Muslims to go to. Because it's saying all the Muslims and all the pagans, everyone who was there. But wait, brother, Muhammad was being persecuted for 10 years in Mecca. And this happened in Mecca, not Medina. You can't play that game with me. Guys, are you actually getting what I'm trying to teach you here? Did you catch it? Did you understand? If you have difficulties, tell me in the chat and I will try to explain it even more. Right? Do you have any difficulties or did you catch it? Give me a one if you caught it. Give me a one if you caught it. This happened in Mecca. All the pagans bow down. Why? Why are the pagans who are persecuting Muhammad bowing down? Because Muhammad gave them the satanic verses. That's why. The punishment of the grave. Abdul, punishment of the grave is an invention by two Jewish ladies. And Aisha called them liars. But when the Jewish ladies left and Aisha went to her husband, right? And she told him about the punishment of the grave. Aisha was not stupid. She knew these two Jewish ladies are trolling her. They are doing jokes. Why did these two Jewish ladies come to Aisha? Because they knew whatever Muhammad heard from the Jews, he made it into Islam. He made it Islam. Aisha was smarter than Muhammad. She knew these two ladies are joking. They are trolling her. There's nothing called punishment of the grave. But when Muhammad started to hear about it for the very first time, he adopted it, he adopted the jokes, and he made it real in Islam. So there's nothing called punishment of the grave. Jews don't believe in that, brother. Jews don't believe in punishment of the grave. They were trolling Aisha. But the Prophet of Islam, the copy-paste machine, copied it and put it in Islam and we made it Islam from that moment on. Muhammad never ever mentioned punishment of the grave before these two Jewish ladies who were lying to Aisha. He never mentioned it earlier. Why? Muhammad was a nice copy-paste machine, brother. So don't ever bring these things up because we're going to spank you even harder with these facts. Right, brother? They were trolling Aisha and Muhammad took it and made it Islam. So jokes of two Jewish ladies became Islamic terror. It's a terror. It's a nightmare for Muslims. Every Muslim actually must believe in something called punishment of the grave. And they are terrified until they die. They are terrified from it. While it's nothing but jokes from two Jewish ladies. An invention to troll Aisha and Muhammad. Jews did not believe in it. They knew these Jews, they were smart, man. They were always spanking Muhammad with jokes. And Muhammad believed them and put it in Islam. Yeah, and the Jews were even smarter. Exactly, Phyllis. Yeah, Muslims are terrified of punishment of the grave. Well, it's nothing but jokes invented by two Jewish ladies. Ladies, man. So as you see, guys, Muhammad is in Mecca when he's delivering the satanic verses. And all the pagans were happy with him delivering the satanic verses. So all the Muslims and all the pagans and all the jinns and human beings prostrated together with him after reciting the entire chapter. You heard Abdul, guys. Brother, this happened after he finished. Brother, we already know that. We already read it many times. We know. You are not telling me anything new. But the problem is this. All the pagans. But the pagans, brother, how can all the pagans bow down if this is a lie, if this is fabrication? This is actually an historical event in the life of Muhammad. The satanic verses is an historical event in the life of Muhammad. Because Sahih al-Bukhari, don't say Sahih al-Bukhari is lying. No. From the mouth of Muhammad, Ibn Abbas, the cousin of Muhammad, saying the Prophet performed a prostration. When he finished the entire chapter, Surah An-Najm, all the Muslims, all the pagans who persecuted Muhammad, and all the jinns and human beings prostrated along with him. Why? Because the pagans believed actually that Muhammad was saying beautiful stuff about their idols. He gave them the satanic verses. Everyone that day, along with Muhammad, became a mushrik boy. All of you Muslims who were present there became mushrik, together with the pagans, who were already mushrikeen. Bam! How are you going to refute this, Muslims? Why are you doing all kind of mental gymnastics, all kind of tap dancing? You cannot get away from this. Right? You cannot get away from it because this is talking about all the pagans. But wait, the pagans in Mecca were persecuting Muhammad immediately after Jibreel came, right? So Jibreel came and corrected Muhammad and then Muhammad started again to attack the pagan idols, right? After getting spanked by Jibreel, Muhammad went again to the pagan. Pagan, I made a mistake. The Satan made me do it. No. That was Satan who gave me the satanic verses that I delivered to you. And then Jibreel came to correct me, spanking me. Right? Spanking me. I was wrong. And what did he say? All the prophets, they had a companion in the shape of Al-Abyad. Al-Abyad was the companion of all the prophets. God forbid. What a blasphemy, man. Here, Muhammad is lying about all the prophets, right? Guys, raw refuted. I love it when you make a nickname like mine and saying raw refuted. How am I being refuted, donkey? Yeah, donkey, son of a donkey. Donkey, son of a donkey. Call me and we are live, brother. Where are your imams, brother? So guys, as we explained to you, on September 24th, the year 622, the Prophet Muhammad completes his hijrah, right? He flee from Mecca to Medina to escape persecution. Did you catch it, guys? Muhammad was being persecuted by the pagans. Now think, why would all pagans bow down and prostrate together with Muhammad? Well, at the same time, they are persecuting him. Because at that very moment, when he was delivering the satanic verses, he was saying beautiful stuff about their idols. All right? Ryan Hussein called me. Okay, let me call him back. Pick up, Abdul. This is you, right? Pick up.
Hello.
Hello, Ryan. Welcome. You're live on air.
Hello.
Are you a Muslim?
Hi.
Are you a Muslim?
Yeah, of course.
Okay. Go ahead. Go ahead.
Okay. I want you to read Tafsir of Ibn Kathir regarding the satanic verses, please.
You want me to read Ibn Kathir?
Yeah, because your teacher, Christian Prince, he read it and he confirmed that Ibn Kathir confirmed the story of Al-Gharaniq, satanic verses.
So let's say Ibn Kathir is calling it fabrication. What about Sahih al-Bukhari?
No, your
what about Sahih al-Bukhari, brother? Is Sahih al-Bukhari liar?
No, see, your teacher, Christian Prince, said that Ibn Kathir confirmed it. First of all,
Christian Prince is not my teacher. That's number one. Number two, are you telling me that Sahih al-Bukhari is lying?
Why are you copying me?
How am I copying him?
Yeah, I have video word to word, sentence to sentence. Are you lying to me?
Brother,
sentence to sentence.
Brother, did Sahih al-Bukhari lie? Sahih al-Bukhari is in front of you. Did Sahih al-Bukhari lie? When it says all pagans, all Muslims, read it. It's in front of you. Read it.
Yeah, I'm reading.
Okay,
read it. The Prophet performed prostration. So where did it say the Satan put words in the mouth of
read
the
it,
Prophet?
Read it.
It says they prostrated, you idiot.
Read it. Let's see who's the idiot. Read it.
The Prophet, it said they prostrated, a prostration.
Read it, don't waste my time, read it.
Okay, I believe in this.
Okay, read it.
The Prophet said, I have read it. Prostration, when he finished reciting Surah Al-Najm, the Muslims and the pagans and the jinns, human beings, prostrated along with him, yeah.
What did it say? All the Muslims and all pagans, right? All pagans, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so why would pagans wait, Abdul, why would all the pagans prostrate in front everybody like Muhammad? Why?
Personally, see, I'll tell you what I know. Why? So something that I don't know, I'll not say it.
Okay, say it. Why did all the pagans who rejected Muhammad bow down together with Muhammad? Why?
Let's read the tafsir.
Abdul, get lost. Don't waste my time. I have no time for kids. Okay? He said, I believe in Sahih. Okay, why? Why is this mentioned, narrating Ibn Abbas, saying that all the Muslims, all the pagans who were persecuting Muhammad from the very beginning, why did they bow down? Don't waste my time, man. You see? He knows he's in trouble. He knows. All the pagans. Brother, what did we just read? This chapter happened in Mecca. Thank you. And the caller before him confirmed it that this happening in Mecca. right? And Muhammad in Mecca was being persecuted. Persecution, brother. This is why Muhammad left Mecca and went to Medina. They are pagans. They are rejecting Muhammad. They are persecuting him. Why? Because he's attacking their pagan idols. After Jibril, who came, who corrected him. Jibril, spank, spank. What have you done? You delivered the satanic verses. You recite to people that which I did not bring from Allah. This was al-abyad, shaitan al-abyad, shape-shifting, like Jibril, as we mentioned earlier, right? Who delivered the satanic verses to Muhammad, and Muhammad gave them to the pagans. This is why the pagan Quraysh, happy with Muhammad. Do you see it? Muhammad has mentioned our idols with complimentary terms. The pagans were happy. This is why they are bowing down. Do you see it? Uh-oh. You see, guys, exactly Sarah. Sarah, you said a very important thing. Guys, look what Sarah is saying in the text. Christian prince is too patient with these Abduls. I hate wasting time with those hypocrite and ignorant Muslims. Exactly, Sarah. I am a person, for the people who have been watching my live shows and my videos for the last year. I'm doing this for 1 year, guys. I'm doing live shows and videos on YouTube for 1 year. And I'm doing this kind of work for at least 14 years now. I don't have patience with liars and deceivers. I simply cannot deal with liars. I am trying to give them time, right? I am allowing you to call me. But when I find out that you are tap dancing, you are not answering, I'm going to hang up on you. I have no time for liars. Exactly. Guys, you see why all the pagans and the Muslims and the jinns and the humans prostrated? Because Muhammad gave them the satanic verses. And he bowed down, and they bowed down. To Allat al-Uzza wal-Munat. Thilka al-Ghuraniq al-Ula. Inna shafa'atahunna laturtaja. Bam. Deal with it, Muslims. Guys, let us change it a little bit now. You know, don't make it boring all the time about Muhammad, the mushrik pagan boy. So we showed you guys that Muhammad committed horrendous sins, right? Like the shirk, he became a mushrik. And all the pagans bowed down together with him, and he became a mushrik that day. Then Jibril came and spanked him and said, uh-oh, what have you done? It was not me, it was al-Abyad, right? It was al-Abyad, right? What kind of other sins did Muhammad do, guys? Let us go back and show you what kind of other sins did Muhammad do. Brother, where is Farid, brother? Farid, brother, you need to do a response video about Farid, brother. Brother. Farid, brother. Oh my Allah, brother. Where is Farid when you need him? You see how these kids can only make response videos. But one day, find out that they are in trouble. Their prophet is in trouble. They are going to start to tap dance. Where's Fifi when you need him, man? This is about, guys, chapter 66, ayah 1 and so on. We are going to talk about Maria al-Qobtiyah. Mary the Copt slave of Muhammad. Who? Mary the Copt slave of Muhammad. Exactly, Phil Herrera. Thank you. Phil Herrera posted the link for you that you can study besides my teaching. Let me start, guys. This is talking about how Muhammad actually slept and committed adultery with Maria al-Qobtiyah. Who is Maria al-Qobtiyah? The slave girl. Right, that was given to Muhammad. So what happened actually, guys, before I start reading the ayahs? The story goes like this. Guys, are you still with me? The story goes like this. Muhammad is in the house of Hafsa. Guys, Muhammad is in the house of Hafsa. right? The same wife that Aisha accused, that she and Aisha, right? She accused Hafsa and Aisha that they poisoned Muhammad. So that wife, yes, that wife, according to Shia, she poisoned Muhammad, not the Jews, together with Aisha under the command of Abu Bakr. That's what Shia believe, right? That's what Shia believe. Aisha and Hafsa poisoned the Prophet of Islam. So Muhammad is in the house of Hafsa. It was her day, right? Muhammad gave for every wife, he gave them days. It was the day of Hafsa. He was in her house, right? And he asked Hafsa basically to go outside and get him something. When Hafsa came back, guys, when she came back, what did she find? She find Muhammad effing the slave girl Maria al-Qabtiya. Mary the Copt slave. Muhammad was doing a bang bang with Maria al-Qabtiya. So he committed adultery, and Hafsa became furious. Oh, Prophet, what have you done? In my house, on my day, Hafsa is saying, you are committing adultery in my bed, on my house, in my house, on my day. How dare you? You call yourself a prophet. How dare you? So she busted him committing zina, adultery, fornication with one of the slaves. In this case, Maria al-Qabtiya. Did you catch it? It's a mistake, brother. It's not a sin, brother. Brother? Fornication, adultery is not a sin, brother? No, no, brother. For Muhammad, it's only a mistake because he's a prophet, brother. Aha! Okay. So guys, she busted him and then she went to Aisha. So Hafsa, she went to Aisha and she complained to Aisha. Aisha, the Prophet of Islam just committed adultery in my bed on my day in my house with Maria al-Qabtiya. So Aisha and Hafsa, the army, the army of wives, they went to Muhammad and they confronted Muhammad with him committing adultery with Maria al-Qabtiya. Uh-oh. No, this is not Safiya, this is Maria. Laura Sarob, we're talking about Maria al-Qabtiya, the slave girl, the Egyptian slave girl. Okay, so Muhammad was confronted by his two wives. So let us now read the Quranic ayahs, chapter 66 from Surah Al-Tahrim, ayahs 1 and so on. O Prophet, why do you forbid what Allah has made lawful for you? Is it to please your wives? Allah is saying. Allah is the most forgiving, most compassionate. Now guys, listen what is happening here. Muhammad started to swear to his wives, I will never ever do it again. You busted me once, I will never ever sleep with Maria al-Qabtiya again, Muhammad is saying. What did the Prophet say? I will never do it again. Forgive me, please. Brother, I made a mistake, brother, not a sin, brother. Yes, I committed zina with the slave girl, I'm not going to do it anymore, right? Because his two wives complained and busted him. And Allah is saying, brother, oh Prophet, brother, why are you forbidding yourself from zina, brother? It's okay, you're the Prophet, it's okay, sit down. So instead of Allah punishing the Prophet, no, Allah immediately hastens to fulfill his sexual desires. Eh? Like Aisha said, Mara Rabbuka illa yusara fi hawaka ya Muhammad. I see that your Lord, Allah, always hastens to fulfill your sexual desires, Muhammad. Instead of Allah punishing Muhammad, like God of the Holy Bible, punishing King David, punishing his son King Solomon for committing adultery, which is an awful sin in the real eyes of the real God of the Holy Bible. No, Allah, i.e. Al-Abyad, Satan, Shaitan, right? Shaitan again, right? Al-Abyad, now in the shape of Allah, saying, Muhammad, it's okay. It's lawful for you, brother. I'm not going to punish you, brother. Why are you trying to please your wives? Uh-oh. So instead of Allah punishing Muhammad, he says to him, continue. It's okay, brother. Listen, keep listening to your penis, brother. Your penis wants to have sex with the slave girl, Maria. Go ahead, brother. Fornication is halal for you, brother. Do you see it? And Allah even prescribed for you a way for the absolution of oaths. Because Muhammad made an oath. He said, I swear, Uqsum fillah. Uqsum lillah, right? Fillah. I am not going to do it anymore. But then Allah says, don't worry, be happy. We gave absolution. You have a way for absolution for your oath. For swearing that you will not do it anymore. Allah is your guardian. Allah is guarding you. Allah is your guardian. Allah is guarding you from your wives. Don't worry about your wives. You see it? And if we continue, I'm not going to read the entire chapter for you, but so it's as you see, then Allah starts to attack. Guys, instead of Allah siding with the wives of Muhammad, with Aisha and Hafsa, Allah is standing with the Prophet, protecting the Prophet, claiming that it's okay, it's lawful for you, Allah is saying. Allah then says, if you two wives, if you, Hafsa and Aisha, if you two, Hafsa and Aisha, guys, are you with me? Pay attention, please. If you, Hafsa and Aisha, you too, if you turn in repentance, if you repent to Allah for attacking Muhammad, so they kept attacking Muhammad, right? That's better for you, for the hearts of both of you have served for this reason. So instead of Allah punishing Muhammad, telling him to ask for forgiveness for committing adultery, sleeping with the slave girl on the same day of Hafsa, in her bed, in her house, Allah is saying, no, no. The women are wrong, you are correct, Muhammad. What? You see how whenever Muhammad was being busted, in this case his wives, instead of Allah attacking Muhammad, punishing Muhammad for committing horrendous crimes, in this case adultery, Allah is saying, no, no, it's okay, brother, go ahead, continue, brother. And he is pointing fingers at his wives, saying, you have to repent. But if you support one another against Muhammad, so if you, Hafsa and Aisha, are against the Prophet, then surely Allah is his protector. And after that, Jibreel, so Allah, it's not enough to be only Allah, also Jibreel and all the righteous Muslims and the angels are all his supporters. What? So guys, you need to understand what is happening here, guys. You have a small girl, you know, Aisha. She's only, let's say she's 18 at that time. I don't know how old she is. No, 18 when she was 18 when Muhammad died. It's before that. Let's say she's 14 years. How long is a 14-year-old girl in the Middle East? Maybe 5 foot? Maybe 4 foot and something? What about Hafsa? Let's say she's 5 foot and one inch. You need all the angels, you need Allah himself, and you need all the righteous Muslims to stand along together against two small ladies. Wow! Repent, O Hafsa and Aisha, or else never ever again attack Muhammad. Never ever bust him saying you committed adultery, because everyone is against you. Everyone is going to support Muhammad. Muslims, really? Don't you think there's something fishy going on here? Don't you think there's something fishy going on here? Every time Muhammad gets busted, Allah comes to his aid. Instead of punishing him, no, no. Like God of the Bible punished King David, punished King Solomon for their crimes against humanity. No, Allah is a coward. Allah is the genie. Allah is the genie in the bottle. Muhammad is, you know, takes his bottle out, his you know, his thing out, starts to rub it, and then Allah pops out. Hello, it's me, Allah. I mean, Al-Abyad, genie, the devil. You two women, if you don't repent, I'm going to protect Muhammad from you. And I will get even better women than you if you don't stop attacking my prophet, brother. Yet Allah doesn't rebuke, he encourages the sin of Muhammad. Of course Muslims going to say Muhammad was not a sinner. If every time Allah is going to protect Muhammad from sinning, actually making it lawful for him to sin, continue sinning, of course Muhammad is not going to sin. Guys, are you understanding why Muslims? Do you understand why Muslims say Muhammad never sinned? Because Allah, every time Muhammad sins, Allah comes to help him instead of punishing him. It's okay, brother. You have all kind of privileges, brother. Yeah, VIP pass for Muhammad sinning. Do you understand why shuyukh, why imams always say, they teach their Muslims audience, their poor victims. Muslims are nothing but victims of this man-made sex cult made by Muhammad for him and him alone, with all kind of unlimited privileges. And the proof is in front of me. So instead of actually helping those poor ladies who busted Muhammad committing adultery, he said, maybe if he were to divorce you. So Allah is saying to them, if you're not going to be good wives, he's going to divorce you and get better wives than you. He's going to exchange you for better wives. You see why Aisha always said, Ma ara rabbuka illa yusara fi hawaka ya Muhammad. I see Aisha saying, quote unquote, I see that your Lord hastens to fulfill your desires, i.e. your sexual desires. Wife exchange program for Muhammad. Yeah. Uh-oh. What a spoiled brat. Do you see how Muhammad actually took Allah from the pagans? He adapted it in Islam because already Allah existed before Islam. The pagans used to worship Allah as the supreme moon idol. And they believed that Allah had daughters who could fly because they were crane bird idols, right? And we showed you, right? That they were bird idols. They could fly all the way to the supreme moon idol Allah, delivering the prayers of the pagans. They were interceding, right? They were interceding for the pagan Quraysh. So these are the daughters of Allah, the pre-Islamic moon idol. Muhammad took him and he made him again Allah in Islam. You see how Allah is no one else but Al-Abyad. He is Al-Abyad. He is the white one. The shaitan called the white one, Al-Abyad. You see it, guys? Muhammad had all kinds of privileges. If we quote the tafsir of Al-Qurtubi, guys, for chapter 33, ayah 50, Muhammad had more than 16 privileges. Let's say 16 privileges, sorry. 16 privileges. One of them, Al-Ashir, the 10th. إِذَا وَقَعَ بَصَرَهُ عَلَى إِمْرَأَ وَاجِبْ عَلَى زَوْجِهَا طَلَاقُهَا وَحَلَّ لَهُ نِكَاحُهَا. That means, guys, and this is the most devastating one in my eyes, in my opinion. The 10th privilege in this tafsir for chapter 33, ayah 50 by Al-Qurtubi, is if Muhammad looks at a married wife of a married, of her husband, you know, a married wife of a Muslim husband, if he looks at your wife as a Muslim, you must divorce her and hand her over to Muhammad so he can immediately start to F her. No limitation for Muhammad. Even if he lust for married women, like the example of Zainab bint Jahsh, his own daughter-in-law, the story of Zainab and Zayd. So not only Zayd, even if, let's say Muhammad now walked on the street in Mecca today, 2020, let's say Muhammad, if he was alive, He would go to Mecca and he walked on the street and he see a very beautiful lady. That lady happens to be married to a Muslim male, to a Muslim husband. Her husband must immediately divorce her and give her to Muhammad so Muhammad can immediately F her without giving her dowry or whatever. The big screen TV goes to Muhammad. The small screen TV goes to the Muslims. Muhammad had all kinds of privileges, and this was one of them. Right, Muslims? Muhammad had no limitations. He had a VIP pass, VIP card for sinning. This is why Muslims say Muhammad was not a sinner. Of course, because Allah always condone it. Allah, the devil Al-Abyad, the white one, always condoned the sinning of Muhammad. Allah was used as the slave of Muhammad, the servant for the sexual desires of Muhammad. You see how Muhammad used Allah for his own sexual desires. Islam was created for one man and one man alone, i.e. Muhammad. Is there any Muslim who dares to call us? My Skype is open. Yes, the VIP pass for sinning was given to Muhammad. Is there any Muslim who has the courage and the knowledge to call me? We are live. My Skype ID is the Rob Christian. What about Al-Hajar al-Aswad? Hajar al-Aswad, the black stone. Hajar al-Aswad, the black stone. Black stone, brother? Yes, brother. I think, guys, I understand why Muhammad was not a sinner. Because every time he sinned, he went to the black stones and he started to rub them like he used to rub the bottle of the genie Al-Abyad, Allah, i.e. Allah. Every time he was busted, he went to kiss the black stones, touch the black stones. Why? Here is why. Here is why, brother. If we go to Jama Tirmidhi, this is a Hassan. Don't say this is Da'if, this is Hassan. Hadith. Hadith number 877. Jama Tirmidhi 877. Let me give you the link. Bookmark it and save it, guys. Let me drink something. Yeah, the Hajar al-Aswad, guys, that looks like a vagina, right? Hajar al-Aswad, the black stone. Ibn Abbas narrated that the Messenger of Allah said, the black stone descended from paradise, and it was more white than milk. Whiter than milk, brother? Yes, brother. Then it was blackened by the sins of the children of Adam. Wow! Brother, are you telling me if I, as a Muslim, go to Mecca and I kiss and touch the black stone, my sins will be gone? They will be absorbed by the black stone, brother? By Hajar al-Aswad, brother? Yes, brother. Rub it and kiss it, brother. Don't worry, be happy. If you're a sinner, the black stone will absorb your sins, brother. Rub the fulfa lookalike stone. Rub it, touch it, lick it, kiss it. Your sins will be absorbed by it. Wow! Brother, so if I kiss the black stone, my sins will be forgiven, brother? Yes. They will be absorbed by the black stones, brother. And the proof is in front of you. Brother, now I want to say the Shahada, brother, because I can do sin like my prophet, brother, but the sins, if I go to Mecca, all my sins will be absorbed by the black stones, brother. Yep. By Hajar al-Aswad, that looks like a fulfa. I mean, Fijiji, brother. A meteorite that can absorb sins of mankind, brother. For sure, guys, for sure, the black stone, touching, kissing, and bowing towards the black stone is not an act of paganism. It's not pagan to lick and touch and kiss the black stone, brother. Brother, you Christians, you Jews, you are mushrikeen, brother. But we Muslims are true believers of Allah, the supreme moon idol, brother. Together with his daughters, Allat al-Uzza wal-Manat, and we have also black stones, when we kiss it and lick it and touch it, our sins will be absorbed by it, brother. But for sure, we are not pagans, brother. We know that the black stones, guys, the black stones were taken, they were stolen by the Qaramita, a tribe that attacked Mecca. Allah was silent. He didn't send his bird army as he promised in the Quran. Chapter 105. He used to send his bird army, right? And in this case, against the elephant army. Chapter 105. And our brothers, the admins, can give you the link. The black stones used to look like this, guys. It was the size of a football, as you see. Size of a football. Right? The Qaramita, they took the black stones. It was stolen in the year 317 after Hijrah by the Qaramita. Right? So it used to look like this, as you see, brother. And the Qaramita broke it and made it into a couple of tiny pieces. So more than 90% of the black stones are gone, brother. More than 90% is missing, brother. Where is Allah when you need him, man? Where is Allah to protect his black stone, brother? So the Muslims of today only have a couple tiny of pieces. And this is basically like a stuff, that black stuff that you see here. They put it around it, you know, to give it a nice shape. But they are only a couple of black stones, right? Small stones. Where is Allah when the Qaramita stole the black stones, cut it into pieces, right? They completely destroyed the Kaaba, and Allah was being silent, brother. Where is Allah when you need him? Oh, Allah is only there when Muhammad is getting busted, doing all kind of sins, committing shirk, doing and committing adultery, zina, right? With people like Maria al-Qubtiya. Allah only helps Muhammad when he, you know, when his penis is in trouble. When his penis is in trouble, brother, yes, then only Allah wakes up and comes to help Muhammad. Do you have any Muslim guys? I really hoped that you enjoyed our teaching. And I think we did huge damage again, don't you think? Today was the day, this was my first live show of 2020, of this very new year. And I think we did amazing damage today, thanks to the Lord. We exposed the imams, the shuyukh. We exposed Muhammad and spanked him left and right. We allowed Muslims to call us. We had two callers and we spanked both of them. They had no answer. I wonder why. And we showed you guys that when Muhammad was in Mecca, right, and he delivered the satanic verses from Satan, from Al-Abyad, right, from Al-Abyad, right, he gave them the satanic verses. And Al-Abyad came to him in the form of Jibreel, right, to communicate to Muhammad. Then, after Muhammad was under the influence of Satan in the shape of Al-Abyad, he did damage. Allah was silent. Then, after the damage is done, Jibreel suddenly appears. He says, "Hi, it's me, Jibreel, the real Jibreel." Came to to spank Muhammad, correct him. And then after the damage is already done, Muhammad already become a mushrik. All the pagans were happy with Muhammad and bowed down together with him. All the Muslims who were present became mushrikeen with Muhammad. Then after the damage is done, Jibreel starts to spank Muhammad, correct him, and he pushed Al-Abyad, the fake Jibreel, Satan himself, and he pushed him all the way to India. So we actually advise the people of India to leave India immediately. Leave India immediately, ASAP, because among you, the shapeshifter, Shaitan, Al-Abyad, the white one, lives among you. I advise you to leave India, because Islam says so, guys. Yes, brother. Do we have any caller? Do we have any guest? Brother? Are there any questions, guys? Do we have any Christians who wants to call us? Maybe you want to share something with us, guys. My Skype is open now for the Christians. First, we only wanted the Muslims to call, but now you can call me if you're a Christian too. Maybe you want to share something with us. Maybe you have a question. Go ahead, guys. Maybe in the chat too. I hope you benefited from our today's teaching, guys. I hope you took notes. Andrew Martin is saying, Rob Christian. Oh no, he's addressing Rob Refuted. Did you notice that I pointed repeatedly to Ibn Kathir? That's far worse for your prophet, as I pointed out. Okay. I didn't catch what you said to him, but it's okay. Do you have any Christian who has a question, or you want to call me? Or thank you, Frau. God bless you, my friend. I appreciate it. Is there any question, guys? Rob refuted, you're a coward. You can only use my name and try to mock me. It's okay, brother. It's okay. Brother, if you care for the truth, you can check text instead of calling and hang up on people. Brother, you're a coward, brother. This is why you don't want to call me, brother. I only hang up on liars who are doing the moonwalk, right? Doing the moonwalk around the question, cannot answer the question. Of course, I'm going to hang up on you because you're a coward. You know you're in trouble. Why would I hang up on you if you are true? Just face the fact that even according to Sahih al-Bukhari, Muhammad was in Mecca. He was getting persecuted by the Meccans. But when the devil gave the satanic verses, immediately after chapter 53, ayah 20, تِلْكَ الْغَرَانِقَ الْعُلَىٰ إِنَّ شَفَعَتَهُنَّ لَتُوَتَّرْجَىٰ These are the mighty cranes. Their intercession is hoped for. The mighty cranes of Allah, his daughters. Then, when he finished the entire chapter, before the real Jibreel coming to correct Muhammad, all the Muslims, all the pagans, all the jinns, and all the human beings started to prostrate, sujood, along with him. For who? To Allah, Al-Uzza wal-Manat. Remember, Muhammad is here in Mecca. Muhammad is here in Mecca. And all the pagans started to bow down. But when Jibreel came and corrected Muhammad, spanking Muhammad, Muhammad, what have you done, brother? Brother, what have you done? Then Muhammad went back and he said, I was wrong. It was Satan who made me do it. He started again to attack the pagan idols of the pagan Quraysh. They again started to persecute him all over again. And Muhammad had to flee. Right? He had to flee and he left Medina because they started to persecute him again. That's how the story, the real story goes. Not the story that Muslims tell you. This is the real historical event of the life of Muhammad. Guys, I hope you benefited today. This is the way to deal with the satanic verses incident in the life of Muhammad. This is how. Do we have any Muslim? If you aren't a coward, who is the coward? We are alive for how many hours now? And you still didn't dare to call me. You scumbag. Tell your mom or dad to call me instead. Tell your imam to call me. Is there any Christian who wants to call, guys? Send me a message or... Hi, Sarah. You want to call me, Sarah? You want to call me? Go ahead. If you want to call me, go ahead, sister. Or send me a message and I will call you. Maybe there's something wrong with my Skype. I don't know why Skype sometimes is not working. So I need to call you back if you want. Just send me a message that you want to call me and I will call you back. Sarah, what is true, Sarah? What did you say? Let me scroll back. Rob Christian, some of Muslims, quote unquote, some of Muslims said if Muhammad died after did sex with his wives, even though got poisoned, that's why he need 3 layers of burial shroud to cover his body, because his... I don't know, Sarah. I can't answer that question of yours. It's funny though, but I have no idea. I didn't check out his peepee to know if it's hard or not. That's... Oh man. I have no idea. I didn't study that, so I can't answer your question. Andrew Martin, my friend. Andrew Martin. Can you hear me, Andrew Martin? You mentioned Ibn Kathir. Can you enlighten me why you mentioned Ibn Kathir to that Muslim? I want to understand what you said to him. I didn't catch up on the chat because when I'm teaching, I don't always check out the chat. Can you elaborate, please? I want to read what you told him about Ibn Kathir. Squeeze me, Jibril. Yes, we can. Squeeze me, Jibril. You can find the link under the comment section or in the live chat in that live show about Muhammad being a bisexual. Let me see if I can give you... that link again. Just a second, okay? Bear with me, my friend. Where did I put it? Let me go to the live show and get it for you. You can go look it for yourself, my friend. You know, but no problem. I will do it for you. We always, guys, for the people who don't know, we always put in the comment section the links. So here's again the link. You can always find the links of our teachings, guys, in the live shows, under the comment section, when the show is over. Or you can find it in the live chat, right? So let me give you the link again. Please don't be lazy, guys, but here's the link. Okay? Make sure to always look in the comment section or in the live chat again, because you can rewatch the live chat to find the links. Let me see if Andrew Martin, did you answer my question, my friend? Andrew Martin, are you there, my friend? I asked you about Ibn Kathir. You mentioned Ibn Kathir to that Muslim guy. I want to know what you said to him about Ibn Kathir, because maybe we can share it with our audience. Maybe he's not here listening, or maybe he's not here. I don't know. Okay, well, it's okay. Is there any other question, guys? Is there any question? Do we have any Muslim? Then I think I need to rewatch my own live show again and check out what Andrew Martin said. Maybe he's at work or something that he cannot hear me. I respect that. I understand that. You know, sometimes. Are there more questions, guys? Do you have any imam or ustaz who wants to call me and refute our today's teaching that Muhammad actually was visited over and over, and we showed you from three different places in the Quran by Al-Abyad in three incidents. He visited him three times, thrice, and gave him and assisted him with all kind of satanic verses. We showed you from three different ayahs. Let me scroll back. Chapter 22, ayah 52. You can go do some study on it. Chapter 59, ayah 16. And chapter 81, ayah 25. So Muhammad was visited at least three times, according to the Quran, by Al-Abyad, Shaitan, who used to shapeshift in the form of Jibreel and gave him the satanic verses. This is according Al-Razi, for example, right? It's reported from Ibn Abbas, the cousin of Muhammad, and Al-Qurtubi. These are big daddies in Islam, right? Big daddies. These are not just normal Muslims. These are big daddies who are mentioning Muhammad being visited by Al-Abyad, who can shapeshift in the form of Jibreel, who is nothing but a shaitan acting like being the real Jibreel. That's a good one. Life is good. Guys, I think we are out of Muslims. We are out of Muslims. We have only a coward who is using my nickname. Right? But the jokes is on you, brother. You are a follower. And today we proved it to you. You are a follower of a mushrik prophet, Muhammad, attacking all the prophets, claiming that all the prophets had a sahabi, and in this case, Al-Abyad, right? Their companion is Al-Abyad, claiming. You see how Muhammad is lying about all the prophets, guys? Claiming that all the prophets had this companion, Al-Abyad. All of them, one by one. And he called him Sahib al-Anbiya. What a lie. You Muslims need to wake up and deal with these disasters. You see, and again, no imam or sheikh dares to call us to refute us because they know this is true. You know, but the poor Muslims, the victims of this cult, are afraid, let's say, from punishment of the grave. It's nothing but a Jewish invention, trolling Aisha and Muhammad. They are scared from the penalty for apostasy. Islam used all kind of scare tactics, and still till today, The shuyukh and the imams and the ustaz are using scare tactics to keep those poor victims of Islam, the Muslim Muhammadans, who are suffering from Abdulism in this man-made cult. Scare tactics to keep you in this man-made satanic sex cult of Muhammad. Please leave this cult, man. Please come back home to Jesus, your Lord and Savior. Jesus Christ. Wake up, Muslims. Yeah, why don't we call Imam Murra? Why don't you call me Abdul? What has Imam Murra has to do with this? Are you trying to... Brother, proving that Muhammad became a mushrik over and over and over again. To justify it, claiming that all the prophets were visited and they had a companion in the shape of Jibril. His name is Al-Abyad, right? Shaitan called Al-Abyad, who was the companion of all the prophets. What a shame, what a lie. You Muslims truly have no shame to attack all the prophets and claim that all the prophets fell for the deception of the shaitan. You need to wake up, Muslims, because no true prophet encountered such a blasphemy. Blasphemy. Wake up. Wake up, Muslims. Is there, if there's any Muslim, call me, I'm live on Skype. My Skype ID is DRobChristian. Wake up. Sam even washed his hands from you. Boo-hoo! No, brother, Sam is my brother in Christ. Brother, why are you not calling me, brother, to refute me, brother? Is that the only thing you have, brother? Sam is my longtime friend. Sam is a dear brother of mine. I mean, brothers can be angry with another. Big deal. Go ask Sam right now and see what his reaction is. Sam has a hot temper, but so what? We are still brothers. I can be angry with my own brother. We are humans. We can be angry sometimes. Big deal. Brother, but Sam, brother, but brother, your prophet is a mushrik pagan boy, brother. Why are you not refuting that, brother? But brother, Sam, brother, Sam, brother. Sam? Is that it? Oh, man, that's it. I have nothing else to say, brother. I know you spanked my prophet today, brother, showing everybody that Muhammad is nothing but a mushrik. But Sam, brother. Bible. You want to go to the Bible now? Coward. Yeah, Jaban ibn Jaban. You coward, son of a coward. That's what you are. This video will be refuted. Good luck, brother. Good luck. Good luck. But don't download the video, brother, and only address a couple parts of it. Address the fact that your prophet was a mushrik. We showed you over and over. We proved to you, even Sahih al-Bukhari, that you Muslim loves to go to, saying that all the Muslims, all the pagans in Mecca, all the jinns and humans prostrated with Muhammad to Allah al-Uzza wal-Manat, because Muhammad at that very moment delivered the satanic verses. Why would all the pagans in Mecca who are persecuting Muhammad bow down together with Muhammad? Why? Ask yourself why. At the same time they are persecuting, but at the same time all the pagans of Mecca are bowing down. Because at that very moment, before the real Jibril came to correct Muhammad, they were pleased with Muhammad. Muhammad, and they said, quote unquote, the pagans said, right? They said, Muhammad has mentioned our idols with complimentary terms. This is why they started to bow down. All of them bow down, including the Muslims. Do you see it? All the Muslims followed suit and prostrate, and all the idolaters who were present prostrate. This is nothing but a copy paste of in Sahih al-Bukhari. Do you see it? Copy paste. Copy paste, brother. So never ever use Sahih al-Bukhari to refute it, because you cannot refute it, because it clearly says that all the pagans, this is in Mecca, this is when Muhammad already gave the satanic verses, this is before Jibreel coming to correct Muhammad, because this happened before Jibreel came. Jibreel then after that came and said, what have you done, Muhammad? You recite to the people that which I did not bring from Allah. These were the satanic verses from Al-Abyad, Satan. Right? You said what I did not say to you, says Jibreel. Pointing fingers at the Prophet of Islam. What have you done, Muhammad? You see? This makes perfect sense. So Sahih al-Bukhari actually does more damage then you want to. Don't ever go to this hadith potato. Who is the potato now, brother? Your prophet was a huge pagan potato. A mushrik, son of a mushrik. Like his father, like his mother. Both of them are burning in hellfire. Right? They were mushrikeen. Like his uncle. And his other uncle. Actually, the whole family of Muhammad were mushrikeen and they died like mushrikeen. Right? All of them, one by one. And even his own pagan tribe did not accept him. They knew Muhammad is a scam. I mean, isn't it fishy, guys? Think with me here. Why would your own uncles, two uncles, won't accept you? Why? Why? Because they knew, they raised Muhammad, right? His own uncle used to sleep in one bed with Muhammad. He asked Muhammad to remove his clothes, come naked in my bed. He knew, he raised Muhammad. He knew that Muhammad was a fake. Like Aisha knew Muhammad was a fake. مَا أَرَى رَبُّكَ إِلَّا يُسَّعَ فِي هَوَاكَ يَا مُحَمَّدْ. I see that your Lord always hastens to fulfill your sexual desires, Muhammad. Do you want me to scroll up? Okay, let's see. Chapter 66:1. Yeah, about Muhammad being confronted by his own wives. I know, we already mentioned that, Andrew. Muhammad was confronted by Aisha and Hafsa for committing adultery. Yeah, we already discussed that. Chapter 66, ayah 1, and so on. Right? And Allah coming always to his aid, we know it's Al-Abyad, coming to his aid, instead of punishing Muhammad for his sexual crimes, committing zina, adultery, no, Allah said, it's okay, you are lawful to do that. Why are you trying to please your wives? Right? Why are you trying to please your wives? And instead of punishing Muhammad, he is starting to attack the two wives of Muhammad. Muhammad is going to divorce you if you don't repent. And he is going to exchange you with wives better than you, says Allah. I mean, i.e. Al-Abyad. Right, Muslims? Guys, I think we are out of Muslims. We have only a couple of coward Muslims in the chat. Thank you for watching, guys. Like I said, please don't forget to subscribe. Smash that like button. Destroy that like button. And click on the notification bell to receive notifications when we go live, like today. Help me to help you. Thank you for watching, guys. I hope you benefited from today's live show. I hope you took notes. Download our videos, guys. Upload them on your social media. If you like a part that you want to share with your friends on social media, please go ahead. My videos are your videos. Always take notes when we teach. Use them for your benefit to expose this man-made sex cult created by one man for his own sexual desires. Thank you for watching, guys. Be blessed in this new year. God bless you. Thank you for your support. God bless your families, your loved ones. Without you, we cannot do this, guys. Thank you for all the support that I received from you in the last 1 year, last year, in 2019. Because of you guys, we can still keep doing what we do. And we need to expose this man-made cult. And only the truth will set us all free. It's all about the truth. It's not about me. It's not about you. It's all about the truth. Muslims, you need to wake up and accept that Muhammad was the biggest sinner of them all. He was the sinner. Don't ever, ever dare to say that Muhammad did not commit sin. Today, we proved that Muhammad is a sinner. He became a mushrik. He delivered the satanic verses. He used to be visited by the demon Al-Abyad, the white one, over and over and over. And we showed you from three different ayahs from the Quran. Muslims, please wake up. Please drop Muhammad, denounce Islam, denounce Muhammad, and come back home to Jesus, your Lord and Savior. Every knee will bow and proclaim that Jesus is Lord. Muhammad is a fake prophet. Islam is false. And Jesus is Lord. Thank you for watching, guys, and God bless.